Oops, I said ready to go live. I'm just waiting for it.
I think it said the broadcast is now live. Oh, on
we are now live. Great. How's We're it going, live. Everyone? We are live. Headphones, default mic. I'm good. How are you?
I'm good. You know, I'm good. It's good to be back.
We live, Jack. You know, it wasn't clear, but you know what happened this week?
We beat fascism. Yeah. It's over.
We restored democracy.
America's back. You know, we restored democracy. This is fine. You know, I saw people posting the "this is fine" meme, you know, the really? Dog in the fire, but without any fire, you know, because that is
a joke. Are you serious or is that a joke?
I saw someone post that. I did see, you know, what the hell is her name?
Got to put on lipstick, guys. Sorry. Yeah,
somebody posted that. Anyway, it's all over. The nightmare's over and we're Freak all good now. Everything's good.
Everything's going to be all right. Don't worry about a thing.
Feel free to check out. Actually, that is truly my feeling about the election is that, you know, liberals promised that they would check out after this. And so I really hope that they do. I mean, like if they please would keep their promise and also stop voting would be really good also.
Yeah. And stop entering the discourse. We don't need you in the discourse anymore.
If
right?
They said they were going to go back and stop ignoring, go back to brunch. It's time. It's time for that to happen. It is time for that to happen.
Well, you know, we live in a world where now checking out, you have to be doing it to have brunch. You have to check out. No, I'm not check out. Order in, I guess.
I guess you have to order in. Well, you know, this has been a controversial stance of mine, but this is why I also think we need to open up immediately is because liberals need to get back to brunch. We need them out of politics. Right. And so, unfortunately, I know it'll hurt a lot of people, but we need the cities open again. We need brunch open so that liberals can go to it and leave everybody else alone.
Yeah, and be quiet. Yeah, I agree. So, you know, Trump said it was going to be open for Easter. Let's open it for now, for the libs.
Now, let's go. Let's go for the election.
And thank you, BHX, for your super sticker. Very generous off the bat. Off the bat.
Super sticker right away. That's incredible. Sticker.
Yeah. You know, we're going to have on, by the way, just want to remind everyone that this is a moment that you can, you know what you can do? You can, like the stream, wait until the, Brian Frederick, you can do a super chat like Brian Frederick just did. And why is that? Because then you get me reading your message. And, as critics, my very smart viewers of the show have been like, Katie's beholden to the donors. And it's true. The donor class of YouTube runs my show. So Brian, one such donor, writes, wait until the Republicans take over the House and Biden cuts deals with them to reduce social programs. Yeah, of course. I mean, yeah.
Haven't the Republicans kept the House? I mean, they kept the Senate.
They kept the Senate.
We lost seats in the House.
In the House, but we still have the House.
That's what it is. That's what it is. Okay.
Which is why Nancy Pelosi
we just have it less. We just have
quivers.
It less.
And, yeah, exactly. Yeah. Use all the arrows in her quiver. And also we have... we have the House and we have, we may have the
presidency.
Senate. Oh, we got the presidency. And
that's big. Yeah.
Did you watch I had Trevor Bilyeu on last night, but did you watch to do an emergency live stream about the Republic? Did you watch Biden and Kamala's speeches?
You know, I actually did the very classic, you know, old school American thing of I listened to it on the radio. I actually did not watch it. I saw the images of it afterward, but I was picking up my wife. And so I listened to it.
You were picking up your wife with excitement. So you couldn't watch the TV.
No, yes, I was throwing her up in the air with so much excitement. No, she went to visit a friend on the patio and I was going to drive to pick her up at that time.
What's the patio?
Just her. Well, she went to her friend's patio for a socially distanced, you know,
like
fucking
on your patio. I was like, is it your house far away from the patio? You have to drive.
She went to another patio to have a socially distanced, you know,
OPP.
Hangout. Yes, an OPP. OPP. Yeah. I did listen though to both speeches. And you know what? I am very, very interested. I'm very excited for this future of civility and decency. And, you know, I don't know what the plan is to get us there, but that seems to be the core plank of what the Biden presidency is going to be all about is no more cussing, decency, and everybody being nice to each other. And I'm like, okay, sounds good. Let's go. Let's do it.
I just realized the core plank, Jack. Keep planking. Good for your core. There's
so
much. It's planking all coming together. It is, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, I think it makes sense that you watch, yet you listen to it, you didn't watch it, because what is a better symbol of kind of American decency than listening to the radio.
Oh, sure.
Almost has an old school FDR vibe to it.
Well, you know, it is true what they say. Sometimes you listen to it and, you know, different things connect with you than, you know, than if you watched it.
Right.
And so I was able to really, really listen to how there was not a thing being said at all in either speech. I didn't see the white suit that people were talking about
and how Kamala had a white suit.
I just heard nothing being said at all. I basically listened to white noise for like 20 minutes in the car.
Right. Yeah. It was that. And, you know, it's interesting. They did an SNL, by the way. Did you see the SNL?
I'm opting out. I'm opting out of SNL. Yeah. I just simply can't do it anymore.
Well, and Brian Frederick again asked, how long will it take for Trump to concede? Unclear. I don't know, honestly. I think he'll be waiting for a long time. But,
You know, it's like with Trump. You know, I thought for a second there that it was going to be some real trouble with Trump, you know, when I thought that he maybe had actual real legal support. But then this week when they're like, it's like Jared is trying to find the lawyer for him. And like I see these legal things and I'm like, man, he just like doesn't have the team. You know what I mean? He doesn't have the people there. So I don't know. Trump conceding. I think really at this point, he's just like trying to find a way to never concede, you know, but also, but, you know, still leave office. He's going to leave office, but be like there. This was, you know, very unfair and it's not true. Yeah. And blah, blah, blah. And he's also going to keep raising money for his campaign forever. He's
and they'll talk about how much the media hates him. I mean, it's really going to. But, you know, what was amazing to me about the SNL opening sketch, cold open, whatever it's called, is that they're so bad. Like Jim Carrey is brilliant, but he was not very good at Biden.
He's doing something weird with Biden.
It's not good at all. And the only person who did a remotely decent, fairly good, I would say, impersonation is Maya Rudolph, I always forget which it is.
Maya Rudolph as Kamala.
As Kamala. Yeah, she is. I'm not high, by the way. She's
I am.
Oh, well, that's
but always.
From every other night. Yeah. Let me actually close out these comments because some of them are distracting me. I like the comments when we want to hear them, but when we don't want to see them, they can be rude and distracting. So let me I had Trevor on last night and he kind of dragged some of the people who are saying,
you know, I got to be honest that somebody said, is this a slob off? And I have to be honest with you. It's all right. My couch does have shit all over it, but I truly did clean my entire room yesterday. I mean, look, it doesn't look good because I put clothes on the couch just now. My wife came in and was like, here's the clean clothes. But the floor, everything is so clean in here.
Except
I spent
the
whole
couch,
day yesterday.
Right.
You should have seen what it was like before yesterday.
Well, why are people calling me a slob? I mean, all you can see behind me are some books, a book on Islam, a porcelainish pig, and a nice smelling candle. So I'm open to criticism, but this just isn't. I mean, and honestly, the irony is if you saw a wider screen, a wider frame, you'd be justified in calling me a slob, perhaps. Right. I'm not going to say that. I'll say that maybe.
I should toss the clothes on the ground.
Yeah, you want me to?
Except honestly, that now I am, you know.
Defiant?
I'm defiant at this point. Yeah. Now I'm just defiant that I'm not going to do it just, you know, because just to not do it pretty much.
Whoever that person is.
I don't even care.
Hating on us in the chat. I just want you to know that we don't care about you at all.
I do, but I'm going to leave it the way it is.
But
I'm going to leave it the way it is anyway.
That's avoidant, and I'm hateful.
I do. I was just amazed
by how bad, honestly, like, again, Maya R. was the only good impersonator. She's pretty good at she does the hands, like the hand movements, the facial expression, and the voice is pretty good too. But like, I just really don't. I thought, but who was the guy playing Wolf Blitzer is really bad.
I don't know.
You don't watch it. Anyone know who the guy was playing Wolf Blitzer was? He sucked.
I can't do it anymore.
And the person, thank you, MCBS. And the person, thank you for the generous super chat, MCBS. Jim Carrey sucked. And then Alec Baldwin is so overrated. Patrick Emmett, don't let the
Alec Baldwin,
get
I saw,
down,
I saw he held a piece a paper at the end that said, you're welcome.
Oh, yeah. Actually, you know what's funny is
that's really funny.
Owen Higgins tweeted that and it was like major peak Lincoln Project energy.
Jesus, that is the most. Yeah. That is like so embarrassing.
We
that
do have truly to, embarrassing. It's so embarrassing. Cam 35 millimeter. It's true. The patio party's first agenda: free the slobs. We do have to have a patio party, as in like a political party, right?
And a party, both. And a party, both. Yeah. You know, we have to have both.
We gotta have both. Yeah. what else? And by the way, okay, let's see. Jonathan Tipton Mayer, Chappelle gave the acceptance speech I needed. That was interesting. So you didn't see anything. I'm just going to keep asking.
I read a little. I read some recaps of it, but I read a little of what Chappelle said. And, you know, and I don't dislike Chappelle, even though I do think he's gotten a little older and is annoying a little in some ways. Yeah. But man, I just SNL. I think it needs to be done. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I'm really hoping that post Trump, like, we'll find out that like. Maybe a lot of this media stuff needed to go. You know what I mean? Maybe Trump was the last sort of gasp for a lot of these like right. TV shows and shit like that.
Yeah, I think that I was just amazed again by how bad it was. I don't have anything that deep to say. And I just want to give, by the way, people, I want them to know that. So I'm really tired.
Yeah.
I mean, well,
everyone's been up all week.
You know, I don't even know why, though. Week, I didn't even.
Like, I'm awake yeah. all night, all this shit.
Yeah, the Lincoln Project is dangerous. Thank you, Daniel. We're going to review that because I talked about that a little bit on Twitter. But, you know, I just want you to know that we have some amazing guests coming on tonight.
Yeah.
Your humor made me made me like dead bodies more. Than before.
I don't know what that's about, but that's all right.
Definitely take that on off, especially because we're about to bring in our first guest. Don't want to greet him with that. But our guests are, we're really excited. We have two great guests. First, we're going to be talking to Chuck Rocha, who was a senior Bernie advisor. He also calls himself, he self-identifies as Mexican redneck. And he's wrote a really good book. I'm not just saying that. You know, when people come on, you have to say it was a good book, but it's really well written and engaging. And it's called Tio Bernie. And we're going to look at the cover of that soon and stuff. But let's just bring into the chat if he's ready, if he gives me the thumbs up. Yeah, two thumbs up. Okay, ready? Chuck Rocha. Let's see. Hello.
Hey there.
Hey, sister. Hey.
How are you?
What's going on?
I'm good for Sunday night. Yeah. I ain't drunk yet, so it's good.
Oh, that's good. Okay. Baby steps. Well, you know, we drink on the show. Feel free to drink, by the way.
Don't worry about it. I'm way ahead of yourself.
Oh, there you go. Okay. Oh, so you're drinking, but you're not drunk yet. Got it. Yeah. This is my Sunday night co-host, by the way, Jack Allison.
Hi there. Nice hey, to Jack. Meet you.
Nice to meet you. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So how are you feeling? Are you exhausted? Are you tired? What are your feelings and thoughts on where we are right now?
You know, it's been a process. It's been... I was thinking about it. I was telling my fiance tonight, I was like, it may be one of the craziest years I've ever had. I mean, doing what we've done and with Bernie and, you know, just kind of dedicating my life to that. And then I've told people this and they don't understand. You two get it because you're kind of political animals. But like when you're in charge and then we were all told to go home and then we lived through the consolidation and the losses there at the end when I knew we were really close to being the nominee. And I wrote about it in the book. I know that's why you're shaking your head. And we were so close. And then I had to go home and then we had to lay everybody off. And then, you know, I'm an old hack at this and I've been, not that I'm good or bad. I've just done this a long time and messed up a lot. So I've done it for 31 years. And it's really hard when you know, especially these Bernie kids, because they really like, they're all in, right? And so they look at me as the old goat. I tell them what to think about and what, you know, don't take it so hard this way. So not being able to hug them, tell them you're going to win another election. What we're doing here is really special in this movement. This movement will live beyond Bernie Sanders. What y'all are doing, it'll set the next stage. Like all of those things just don't come across in a tweet. Those things just don't come across in, you know, on a Zoom call with a bunch of staffers, right? Like it means something when you're embroiled in a battle every day. When you're screaming across the room at somebody, when we were before COVID, right? When we would like grab people and figure out what we were going to do, right? So that is just, that was the hardest part. And then everything else has kind of like worked itself out. Campaigns, we beat Donald Trump, yay. And so like the camp, my firm, I own Solidarity Strategy. So I was a consultant before, still am. I own the largest person of color on political consulting firm. And I left Bernie not having any clients, thinking, man, it's going to be a tough year because I spent the last year pitching. But I was Bernie. And so I went over and kind of went all in. If you read my book again, I talk about building out the campaign and stuff. And so I've just been blessed because we had more work than we knew what to do with. And then none of it had to do with Bernie or any of Bernie candidates. It was just like being at the right place at the right time. And there was an ungodly amount of money out there. And, you know, luckily enough, people called us and wanted to hire us good people. Like, we didn't work for any candidates because they had already hired all their people. But people like Indivisible, Move On, some of the environmental world, a lot of the Latino world. Then I created Nuestro PAC. So it really kept me busy.
Yeah. And we're going to obviously talk about Biden and Trump and where we are right now. But just kind of looking back for a second, what insights do you have about, for people who haven't read the book, what are your kind of the most important insights you think you have about what went wrong, what could have happened, if there was any way to deal with the moderate consolidation?
You know, you start PTSD. I think back about it a lot, right? And when you're as insecure as I am about lots of things, you get up earlier than everybody else, you work longer than everybody else, and you've read my story, you know what my personal story is. I'm not the average political consultant, not just because of the way I talk, but so because I'm insecure, I constantly think about what we could have done better, right? Little things here, little things there. You know, there's a big part that Faz and everybody likes to talk about is, should we have attacked right after Nevada? And I was in those meetings with, would that would have made a difference if we really would have went in? At that point, I'd kind of backed out of the headquarters and I was in Nevada. And then nobody was going to South Carolina. They were all going to other states. And I just could not leave our South Carolina crew. So I flew to South Carolina knowing we didn't have a good shot to win because I had to be the martyr, right? So I kicked myself. Should I have been in more of those meetings back at the headquarters where I could have had influence to say maybe we should have went on attack? Maybe there are a few other things. Other than that, we had played it right. And we were smart about the money that we spent. And the grassroots piece was always going to be there. And the strategic markers on Super Tuesday, there wasn't just, and for all you Bernie folks out there, there just wasn't much we could have done differently with the consolidation. We knew, if you're reading the book, I talk about a meeting we had with Bernie 2 years before he ran, like right after we ran the first time, we all get together at Ari's apartment. We say, can we do this again? What should we be thinking about? And we always knew without her being Hillary Clinton, that we could not win this one-on-one with anybody because nobody was going to hate another candidate like that. They didn't like Hillary Clinton. That's why Joe Biden is the nominee now. Like, we knew white people liked Joe Biden because we had polling to tell us that. So we needed a multi-candidate field of at least three. We needed four. And if we had four, we were always going to win this thing because we knew we could raise the money. We had the infrastructure. So that would be the only thing I could think of. The consolidation. And the funny thing is they knew what we knew. They knew they had to consolidate. Right. They knew they had to consolidate then. Because I had polling that showed we were ahead in every Super Tuesday state the day after Nevada.
Wow.
Yeah, it's just scary, but that's just the truth. I know people don't want to hear that, but I was in the room. This ain't somebody writing a Medium post, some random organizer in Philadelphia. I was there. I mean, I saw it. We knew, right? It was. We don't like to think about winning. We were all like focused on doing our thing, but in the back of the mind, it's like, oh. Because we're all a bunch of radical lefties, we're not used to winning. So we were like, oh, holy shit, like we might actually can do this, right? And so it was very grounding. It was very surreal. You know, I felt bad for, you know, Bernie and the road crew more than anybody. You know, I didn't have to be on the road with him all the time. I chose not to be. It's just not my thing.
Yeah.
And like the folks that were just out there just pounding it every day. Mm-hmm. Like I really felt bad for those folks.
So could there have been, I mean, you're saying that from the beginning, you knew that if it was as a two-person race, is it because like the media was, I mean, is that like accounting for how biased the media is against him? How much the official DNC disliked him? Or is that like, even if they hadn't been a totally unfair playing ground, you think he wouldn't have been able to beat one-on-one at that early of a point?
Anything would have been possible. I'm probably a little old and crass to say that it just couldn't happen. It just wouldn't have been easy.
Yeah.
In a one-on-one, we probably could have done it. We knew, and through the whole campaign, we just could not crack old people. And, you know, here's your first part of Bernie knowledge behind the scenes is that people like to come at me because I'm the brown guy and say, well, why couldn't you do that for black people? And I'm like, well, we did everything we were supposed to do as organizers for black people. We had 100 black staff in South Carolina. They were there for 8 months. It was led by a strong black woman. It was everything that organizing one-on-one says to do in the black community. Hire the community, show up in the community, show respect in the community, spend money in the community. We spent $8 million. Guess what? voters, black voters in South Carolina have one thing in common with old white voters in South Carolina, and that's that they're old. And guess who hates Bernie Sanders? Old people. Mm-hmm. So that was just something we knew we were going to have a trouble with from the beginning, and nothing that we did ever moved that number, whether it was white or black, because old folks just didn't think he could win in the general. And so we would run tests, mm-hmm. we would run ads, we right. would test, because we were trying to move them. We knew but Kate, to your point, if there was three or four people, we didn't need them. When right. it consolidated, because they're such a massive part of the Democratic primary structure, that's why Bernie always said, we got to have more people vote. We need to have young people vote. Right. We knew we needed something to off-track that. So that's kind of the strategy behind mm-hmm. the scenes.
Right. And what about the media's role in, I mean, because it's really interesting what you said about people. Well, there's hating Bernie, and then there's thinking Bernie can't win, right? Which are separate, which yeah. are different things. So
I should have just said they didn't think he could win. They liked
yeah.
him. They
were yeah.
like, yeah, he can't win.
Right. Right. Which is a big, mm-hmm. I mean, the reason that's such an important distinction, I think, is because it really sheds potential light onto the role the media had in, right. in that narrative, carrying water for the narrative that he's just not electable. And like, I brought this up last night, I think, but like, I will never forget that story in The Hill. The headline said something like, Trump slightly leads Warren and Biden. And then you had to get into the article and multiple paragraphs in when you saw the opposite is, the reverse is true for Bernie Sanders, who slightly leads Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's not like a mistake. That's not a, nor was it like a one-off misrepresentation. I mean, the fact that that narrative was clung to so strongly, you kind of can't not look at that, right? When you're looking at what happened.
That's true. And you have to separate out this primary from a regular election. And you can yeah. tell now that momentum means something in a presidential campaign. Momentum means something in a presidential press, Katie, to your point, in a primary, because they're so dialed in, they're primary voters. So they're like all of us. We vote, we listen, we kind of know, right? There's not a whole bunch of uninformed people who show up in a primary. Like, they kind of know what they're doing. So to your point, a media can't affect that. Newspapers can't affect that. People read that stuff and they're like, oh, well, maybe, you know, and they don't really, to your point, they don't hate him. They don't think anything bad. They're just like, we just really got to beat Donald right. Trump, whatever it takes to beat right. Donald Trump, right? So it does really matter in your point.
Yeah, even though the polling showed that he was competitive.
Right. They didn't want to believe that. Anytime you have massive yeah. change in the big right. infrastructure, again, I'm a party guy. I've been a Democratic Party guy since I was 19. The difference is that I never went to college and I was a precinct chairman and I've done grassroots my whole life. Right. But now I'm a big evil consultant, which is fine. Right. If that's what you think I am, you kiss my ass. But that's what I do every day. So right. I'll tell you that it's just different in the primary. And, yeah. and in the primary, what killed me is Joe Biden won states where he had no staff. He won states where we had been working with a couple right. staff. No, we didn't have yeah, yeah. a huge, you know, but that showed that proved to me, no matter what we had done, we couldn't have changed anything because the momentum was already there and it was baked in for those last little bit. So that, you know, we were going right. to lose.
Right. Yeah. And I think that like the media hates Bernie. A lot of the media hated Bernie. It hates him. And you saw that with Mimi Rocha. He makes my skin crawl. I don't mm-hmm. even know what it is, but he makes my skin crawl. Like, that is contempt. But then I think that contempt shapes the coverage so that it and tricks people into thinking that he's just not winnable, not electable. Sorry. So there's some people who hate him who I think maybe are lost causes, who are elites. And then there are a lot of people I think who are just like regular people and who could have
right.
voted for him or would have had the media not all decided, you know.
And there's a lot of operatives that I talk to who talk to me who would never tweet this, but are like, they awe at what we could pull off because they obviously don't think Bernie could win in the general, but the amount of money we could raise from grassroots right. donors, mm-hmm. the way we could run a professional campaign at the same time as running a grassroots campaign. And let me explain that is that Bernie Sanders has millions of volunteers and we would put them together in a distributed organizing plan. And that's great. And that's wonderful. It's a backbone of what we do. But what people don't realize is what really made Bernie different is you had professionals like me who was in it. We spent $44 million on TV. We spent millions and millions of dollars on mail. You can't do either one of those. You can in smaller races, but not in these big races. You got to be able to pull off. Nobody talks about this, but that's what really makes Bernie Sanders different. Other than you have an incredible candidate who stays on message, who's never going to mess up off his message. Like that's a godsend when you've worked with idiot candidates right. like me, but being able to have a true grassroots army, but then also have the money to run a professional, like Who's a persuadable voter? How many times should we touch them? We should send them three pieces of mail. We should do a TV commercial. And then you layer on that, him just giving me free reign with the Latino program. And I just like went and burned a bunch of money, hired 200 Latinos. And like, we're going to do it like we did the Black program. But this time, Latinos' average age is 27. They reacted a lot differently to Bernie. Mm-hmm.
Right. Yeah. I'm just going to call up an image from your book because it was kind of amazing. You start off with a bunch of headlines. Let me just call that up. But before I get to that, what do you think the biggest myths are about the campaign that still remain? About the about the primary, about the campaign, about Bernie's voters, about his support.
I think that the biggest myth is that there's still Bernie bro-ism. Like it was my job, and you read about this in the book, is that I was put in charge early of the campaign. I write in the book about how I turned down the manager job and how I positioned myself to not have to deal with things that would trigger me because I have a temper and I've got a low bar for bullshit, just like my boss did Bernie. So we had to be separated a lot of times. And so I would help hire the staff. Other folks, Ari and Fast, God bless them, would be on the road all the time and dealing with policy and that shit that I did nothing to do with. And because of that, the majority of the staff were women and people of color. And people want to come at me about Bernie bros. And I'm like, every department up here is run by a woman. Every department up here has a person of color, either the director or deputy director. And guess what? I make sure we pull them together once a week and we share information. And I go sit down with the field department and I'm with Becca and I'm with Claire once a week, at least, if not five times a week, talking through field. So field is integrated with politics, was integrated with others. That's why people could never understand why we didn't have a Latino department. But we massively won that vote, Chuck. You know, the establishment would say, how do you not have a department if you killed it? I'm like, because everything was interwoven. Because I had come up in campaigns where they take women or brown or black people and they silo you off. They give you no budget and they give you no power. And you really don't know what's going on in the overall campaign because you're the brown person or you're the black person a lot of times.
Right. Let me just show you this thing. This is like a great image. Hold on a second. Who made the front cover, by the way, of your book, of Tio Bernie?
He's an amazing artist in L.A. called Lalo, L-A-L-O. He's a famous cartoonist. If you're watching right now or listening, Lalo Alcarez he's the one who draws all of the Trump cartoons where he's a caricature.
Yeah.
And he's a Pulitzer nominated. He lives in East LA. He's like La Raza to the bone. And like, we were on doing something together for like some Latino thing. And I was like, I'm writing this book and I want the cover to be really different. And I'm like, what would it take? And he's like, Chuck Rocha. Cause I used to put everywhere Brown Consultants Matter. And he's really been fighting for Mexican artists in LA to have a voice in Hollywood. And so he was like, I'll do it. Don't you worry. I'll do it. So the cool thing about that cover that you're looking at now is lots of the people in that audience are my family, my staff, friends. Oh, wow. I give him my mama's picture. She's in there. My twin grandboys are at the bottom on the crowd picture. And so like he would draw people in like that. And so it was really cool to put like my staff. I can see them now in there. And so,
yeah. Who's where?
Some of the iterations.
Screen. Let's see. Who do I see? Well, obviously you're there with Bernie and AOC. Anyone you want to point out?
Some of my staff. Yeah, you're not going to know any of these people because they're my staff. But like in front of AOC, I see my fiance's picture. And then the way at the bottom is my son and my grandboys. I got two twins you can see behind me, actually in this shot. Two four-year-old twin grandsons that I'm really proud of.
Let's see. Where are they?
Oh,
I see
there.
At the bottom. Yeah, that's really cute. Yeah,
by the barcode. And that's my mom, my sister, and that's my son with the scraggly beard. He took time to really draw it. And Lalo was a big Bernie fan. And so Lalo, I sent him a bunch of crowd pictures. And so these are people from the Bernie crowd, from all the Latinos that would show up. So we would take pictures of it. All the way at the back there, it says Lalo for president at the top.
And
so he put his stuff in there. And so anyway, it was great. It was great working with him.
Right,
I just
here?
Wanted something to be different.
Lalo.
Yeah, that's his signature. So that's kind of you know he drew this.
Right. So this is, I want to show you guys, show people watching this. This is a preview, which you really should, you should definitely get the book. And I'm not going to reveal anything except for, I think I'm allowed to do this, right? Let's see.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Here's the headline. So here's interesting. Ready? Selected headlines. With help from Latino voters, Bernie Sanders hits the Nevada jackpot. Why Arizona's young Latino voters are fired up about Sanders, a political revolution. You can just see all these. Biden versus Sanders, how one Latino family in Iowa is thinking about tonight's Democratic caucus. As Latino clout rises, Sanders leads field and courting them. Bernie Sanders, key to success in Democratic primary, organizing Black and Latinx communities. Then you have Spanish. Sanders, figura como el consentido de los hispanos en Nevada. Nevada. I'm trying to think. Yeah. Buoyed. It's because Chris Matthews made me. I know you're supposed to say Nevada. So obviously in Spanish, it's Nevada. But anyway, what's interesting about this is like this. These are not like familiar. Hold on one second. I just got.
I forgot, Katie, you work in the press. So you like, why didn't I see any? There's 100 headlines there and you never saw any of them.
Well, I mean, I saw some of them, but it's amazing how like these should have been all over. Sorry, on my screen right now? Is this because I got an iCloud?
It's still headlines. How Sanders paid off Iowa's first Latino caucus.
Okay, great. Because I somehow got something happened with my. Okay, here we are. Great. All right. So, but what's amazing is that like so often the headlines were not about this. The headlines were about his problem with Black voters, with Latinx voters, with Latino voters. Mm-hmm. It was like, I mean, as you were saying, and we were saying, there is real contempt for him. But what was this frustrating to you? Would you like, I got so frustrated, I didn't work on the campaign. And every day I would see a headline, I would get so angry because it would be one misrepresentation or another. And like,
it was, yeah.
Then when I went on these people's shows, did you want to like throw things at them?
I did. And you know, at the end, and the hardest thing for me, Katie, is that I'd run this program with, again, I keep saying, me and 200 Latinos ran this program. Okay. And people look at me and like, Chuck, you were this Latino director. I was like, no. I just spent extra time doing that. My job was to run the whole campaign with Jeff and Faz and Ariana and all of us. Like we ran the campaign. I was in charge of the white people work too. We did more work in English, but that's fine. Like I would get past that, which would really aggravate me because again, they want to put us in a silo and think that I just run brown stuff. But I couldn't talk about the program, right? So I had to keep it a secret and not tell the press until I'll never forget. I sat down with my staff and I'm like, we're 2 weeks before the caucus. And I'm like, I'm going to take this genie out of the bottle and I'm going to start calling reporters myself. Like I didn't ask Ariana. I didn't ask the press team. I just like, I'm going to make sure that if Bernie Sanders does not get credit for anything, it's this. So yeah. I start going, hey, I got a scoop for you. Hey, let me tell you, I've spent $2 million talking to Iowa Latinos and they'd be like, what? And they're looking for something to write about that's different. And so I fed them that stuff hook, line and sinker until it became this huge thing, but it still wasn't talked about anywhere. It was just like the Latino reporter at the Times, the Latino reporter at the wherever, right? Mm-hmm. And so I would see it like those headlines I showed you. I swear to God, I do have 100 headlines that we catalog. So I would have them for the book and forever to tell people when they come to me and say, Latinos don't vote. I'm going to say, yes. And we got them to do it for Bernie Sanders, who you don't think of as the second coming of Cesar Chavez every day. Like you have to go and introduce him. And then he is a lot like Cesar Chavez actually. Right. So that was the cool thing.
And and then I've saved all those headlines. So, you know, if one day I can write a book about how dishonest the media was about the fact that was happening.
You have some proof.
And when did you decide, how do you decide when it was time to suspend and when it was time to concede and when it was time to endorse? And was there division and debate over that?
To be honest, that is a Jeff Weaver and Faz, you know, they were with him. They, you know, Bernie trusted me. I got to spend some quality time with him a lot. But in those instances, like I talk about when Bernie had his heart attack in the book and about the role I had to play and how I took charge of the headquarters and I talked to the staff and I was breaking things down. Like I was the nuts and bolts day to day, like you can't run the campaign and run the candidate, especially Bernie Sanders, because he is smart as a whip. He reads all the time. He's constantly coming at you. And he would call Faz 20 times a day, you know, whether it was good or bad, mostly bad. And I talk about that. I know after watching what Faz went through, God bless him, that, and I knew we'd pick the perfect person because he's just so level headed and he's smart. And I was like, I would have gotten fired within the first 4 weeks. Cause like somebody called me and start screaming at me at 10 o'clock at night, ain't going to work. Right. And I love Bernie Sanders. I jump on in front of a car for him every day. So I was just not in that meeting at the end, Katie, to be honest. It was Jeff and it was Faz and they were having those. And I would talk to Jeff a lot, but I was literally trying to shut down the campaign. So when we would lay off people in a state and then move it to a Super Tuesday state and then figure out all of that nuts and bolts, like I was having to figure out how much staff we needed, meeting with Claren Becker, how much field team do we need if we're going to run a real distributed program? Because we've only got 4 weeks here and how many staff do we really need there, right? So somebody had to be doing that. And so that's kind of the role I chose to play, thank God. So I didn't. They didn't tell me, or I wasn't in that meeting.
And you give a shout out in your early on in the book to friends of the show, Nina Turner and Brianna Joy Gray, which is great. And want to know, you know, we mentioned earlier older voters, and there was a division, it seems, between how hard to go on Biden. And do you think that had Sanders pushed the, I was going to say narrative, but it's not narrative, it's the truth. Had he emphasized more Biden's position on Social Security, which he brought up during that last debate, but then Biden would deny it. And then Bernie would be like, oh, go to the YouTubes. You're going to go to the YouTubes. I'm like, no, bring the receipts. Like, say what he said when. Right. And that was like, the way I saw that debate in retrospect was like Bernie preparing Biden for Trump. Like, he seemed frustrated. He was like, Joe, look, you're a good guy. You're an honest guy. Just don't say that. It was like he was coaching him. Was that as frustrating? Like, you know, it was like, because he's too, right. Was that as frustrating for you as it was for me?
It was. And you know what people don't realize, and they probably saw it if they know him as well as you know him, Katie, is that, you know, love him or hate him, Bernie is Bernie. And that's why I will never work for anybody else like Bernie. And Bernie likes Joe Biden. Like, he is his friend. And that's just bottom line. He was not going to let, you know, as much as Faz or other folks or Jeff or other ones were like, you just take his knees now. He's down. Step on his neck. And they were, you know, Bernie's just like, Joe is his friend. I'll just leave it at that. I shouldn't speak out of school other than saying that was probably the reason. And because I knew that there were people in the room, Katie, and I can confirm with you because I would talk to them about the poster. So the polling that we did, the messaging we did, the mail that we did, the TV that we did, all of that stuff. Like, I had a part of that. Like, I didn't do it all. But when we comes to running the campaign, and I'd be like, we're still not going to go. And then we'd have a meeting about what it would mean to go negative and what we thought we would gain. But then when it would come down to somebody actually going and talking to the man, I think that's where I lost. I wasn't involved in that. And it never came back to be like, let's get the swords out.
Right. So yeah.
I'll just, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I get there's like a, there's, what is it? Like, there's tone, there's framing. I get him like not wanting to call him incredibly corrupt, because that's whether or not it's true that there's something very personal with that. But like the Social Security stuff, that's not a character judgment. That's just record.
Right.
So I, as you know, stand so hard for Bernie. But I have to say, I was like, why did you, if only it had been someone who you didn't like as much as Hillary Clinton. Now, to be fair, he didn't hate Hillary Clinton. He worked harder for her than Hillary did herself in 2016. But you could tell that he really had a soft spot for Biden. And it kills me sometimes because I'm like, all right, I'm not supposed to do this.
You should have been
there.
You should have been in. Yeah. You should have been there for 2 years in office. You should have opened up the office. You've been in.
Because it is. It's like, why? You know, this is a little weird for me to say, but it's like, you care about the issues. You know that the issues are important. And are you really going to, out of your personal affection for Biden, let that get in the way of getting yourself into the presidency? I was actually on Useful Idiots when we learned that he had suspended his campaign. I was really angry. I had to take out some curses because I didn't want to seem like overly critical. Not for like, I was afraid to. I just felt bad because it wasn't a good representation of my feelings about Sanders, but I was pissed. Because it felt like it was self-indulgent. Like, okay, I get it. You have your feelings. And then you know how important these things are. You are so morally clear on everything. Medicare for all. Like, that should not, this should not get in the way. But was it also a fear, do you think, that he, how much was it the pandemic and a fear of encouraging people to get out of the house and vote when we didn't really know about how safe that was? And how much was it also, do you think, that he actually thought that he would lose to Trump and Biden wouldn't?
Oh, I don't think he thought he would lose to Trump. I don't think that had anything to do with it. I really don't. I think that the pandemic was just the worst thing. I think it was just like we didn't know what was going on. They were in limbo. I mean, I was outside of that meeting a lot, so it was interesting. And I was, and thanks for mentioning in the beginning of the book, because I was very intentional about calling out Bree and calling out Senator Turner on purpose. Yeah. You know, I got really close with them, and I talk about in the book hiring Breonna Joy Gray, and the senator brought me her, like her and Ari said, this is a woman, we're going to hire her. And I'm like, I've been doing all that. I've not interviewed her yet. What do you mean we're hiring her? And I'm like, oh, right. Cool. And so I kind of tell that story. And me and Bree became really good friends, right? She's this young Black woman. She's so impressive, and she's smart as a whip, right? Like,
I'm
smart about a lot of things. Like, that mainly means drinking, eating, and running campaigns. And then that's it. I've hit my peak. And, she learned and she taught me a lot. And now Senator Turner, we shared an office wall. Like we were in lots of battles together, and she would be frustrated about things that she needed a campaign to do. And I was her guy. Like she would come to me and go, Rocha. She called me Rocha, because I have no title. I'm not a senator. She loved titles. Yeah. That's very important.
Yeah. SNT. Senator Nina Turner, SNT. Yeah.
Right. Rocha, this is what I need. I'm like, don't you worry. I'm going to make that happen. Well, I need this, Rocha. We need to get these people in there. Or we'd be like, these people have to go. We got to get rid of them. You got to fire them. This is what they did. I'm like, okay, that'll be done. Or whatever it is. Like I was, so we got very, very close. And I thought I needed to make sure, because of how much heat they get, because they do speak out a lot about lots of things that, and I think a lot of that is righteous, is that I wanted people to know, because I'm identified as left. I'm identified as a consultant. I'm identified as all these ways. Right. And I needed people to know that I'm never going to badmouth those two. And I think I highly respect them.
Yeah. Yeah. They, a lot of fire. And oh my God, Nina Turner, SNT, she is like an they're both amazing speakers in different ways. Like Nina Turner sounds like a preacher, and she is a pastor, right? Doesn't she? I think she does do that. And then Bree sounds like a kind of a philosopher, like a philosopher combined with like Dorothy Parker or something.
Philosopher is probably fair.
Yeah. And I just wanted to ask, we're bringing in Linda Sarsour, the amazing organizer, who's, by the way, speaking of speaking, her voice is just like, I love, even if she said terrible things, which she doesn't, I feel like I would just love listening to her because the quality of her voice is really, really soothing. But we're going to bring in Linda Sarsour, who is another person who was with the Bernie campaign, and she's also the founder of Empower, which is a really great organization. And she's an organizer based in and from Brooklyn, like me. She's a native New Yorker. So let us welcome Linda Sarsour. Hi, Linda.
Hi, everyone.
How are you? Hi.
You know, I'm cautiously optimistic and you know, moving in the world.
Also love the accent, by the way, as someone who has, I guess I have a mild New York accent, but it's not like yours. Yours is like really.
A little something going on.
My ears. Yeah, a little something. Yeah. So welcome to the show. I've been wanting to have you on for a really long time. I'm so excited to have you on. And I wanted to get both of your insights into what you think happened with this election, especially not to silo you guys, but especially in terms of the Muslim vote, the Latino vote, especially because those things are so rarely written about or represented in the media in any fair or accurate way. And definitely want to get to ultimately what can be done to push Biden to the left. But before we do that, what happened in the general? Do you think he should have had a more decisive victory? I was somewhat surprised, even though the numbers are very high. I was a little surprised. And it makes me wonder if but for the pandemic, maybe Trump would have won. But what are your thoughts?
I mean, I organized in 6 states and with a big focus on Michigan, because that's my second organizing home and home to one of the largest Muslim American communities in the country. And the bottom line, Katie, is the Democratic Party nor the Biden campaign used any field operation. They did not put any boots on the ground. They didn't knock on anybody's door. And my community would have told me if they knocked on their doors, and they did not do that. And so what happened in this election is the people like me and many organizers, many of whom were supporters of Senator Bernie Sanders, or maybe even Senator Elizabeth Warren, we sucked it up. We understand what was at stake in this election. You already know I had my own little run-in with the campaign, that while I was minding my own business in Louisville, Kentucky, But it's never about me, and it's not about who I like. It's not about who likes me. It's about the most marginalized people that I organize with and for every single day. So that's what I saw on the ground. I saw it in Georgia. It was the Black women running to the doors, many of whom are abolitionists, many who believe in Medicare for all. I mean, you're talking about the most progressive people who worked the hardest in this election to make sure that Biden won. And you know, and the people who are analyzing our communities are not people who are from our communities. Right. Even if they look like us or they speak our languages, they are not from our community. They're not on the street in our communities. Right. And so really, we won this election. The movement won the election. And of course, it should have been more decisive. But we live in a country with a lot of racists that Donald Trump emboldened. We also live in a country where with neoliberals who want to now coddle people who literally don't believe people like me should exist. And I'm not really having that. So I'm like, you know, I was happy to defeat Donald Trump, but we definitely didn't defeat Trumpism, and we still have a whole lot of neoliberals out there patting themselves on the back like somehow their brilliance is what won this election.
Right. Yeah.
Well, it's good to see my sister, Linda. It's always good to hear her speak. It's the same as really with the Latino community. There were some good things and some bad things, but the bottom line is what the Latino community, people, if I hear one more person say we're not a monolith, like, of course we're not a monolith. We're so many different people and races and different countries of origin. But the bottom line is Donald Trump exposed the weak belly of the Latino vote because nobody talks to them, right? So if you'll go spend money and even lie to them and say, in his advertising in Spanish, Donald Trump was never saying how good he was. He was just saying, hey, do you really trust this guy who's been in government 40 years? And this guy who did this thing and this immigration thing, like just enough to cut off a few percentage here and there. And a lot of percentages in Florida because of the Cuban vote. And let's keep in mind that Joe Biden spends more money than Hillary or Barack Obama on Spanish language communication. Like, I tip my hat to that. I'm glad that he spent the money. That's good. I have a lot of critiques about how that could have been done better, but at least he did that.
Yeah.
But the thing that really drives me crazy, and I'll summarize it this way, is they talk about Muslims, they talk about Black, they talk about Brown, they talk about Asian delivering this election. And we did in every aspect of that. But now, and I think we're going to get to that, not only on the issues, but on representation. Below the presidential level, where there was $100 million maybe spent on Spanish language communication, there still is not one single Black or Brown campaign manager for a U.S. Senate race. There's not a single Black or Brown person managing any congressional race. And there's no consultants running any of that at any level that look like the folks that are on this Zoom call. Like, I'm just saying that we talk about how these different diverse groups are so important to the coalition, but there's literally none of us in there actually having a voice being heard. And I demonstrate that in an op-ed I'm currently writing, talking about now this is how this could really change and needs to change really, really quickly.
Yeah. And what do you think what were the mistakes made? Like Linda, you were saying they didn't really have a ground game. Chuck, you just referred to mistakes made, but what were some of those?
I would say in our community, it was starting a little late, right? In the Bernie Sanders book that I wrote, I talk about starting early, getting in the community, like Linda said, knowing the community, hiring people from the community. Like, this is pretty organizing 101. I've been doing this a long time. But the key is starting early. They've always taken... Hell, they never talk. I know Linda's frustration. They never even think about talking to Muslims. Let's be clear there. But when they talk to Brown and Black voters, they do it in the last 3 weeks. And that's how anybody's ever done it. Well, Donald Trump did it early, and he did it 6 weeks before Joe Biden. So you only get one chance to make a first impression, especially in language, in Spanish, to my community. So that was the biggest mistake that was made. Luckily, Joe Biden had an unbelievable amount of money. And so he quadrupled the spend, but he did it in the last 60 days. So it got him close enough to have a good outcome. I'm tired of accepting the bare minimum.
That's right.
Right. Yeah, that seems like one of the real issues is like you get this message that's, you know, like you were saying, that's a good point. You know, sorry, one second. Leave them, please. Can you go? Sorry, my dad's like, come, go. I've been with my parents during pandemic, and my dad or the dogs will, with the same frequency, will come into the room with either on their paws or their feet. It's true. It's like the Dems pander to Black and Latino voters, but they don't even pretend to pander to Muslim American voters and Arab American voters.
And not only don't they want to even talk to our communities, although we can be absolute decisive voters.
Yeah.
I mean, if you remember back in 2016, Michigan single-handedly gave Bernie Sanders the biggest political upset in primary history. And then, you know, during the general election, the bottom line is, I'm not going to lie to you, my community really had a hard time with Hillary Clinton, and they weren't really 100% convinced about what Trump can do, how much damage Trump can do. And I had a hard time in Michigan in 2016 general election. And also because Hillary didn't organize in Michigan either. She thought that she had it in the bag. And so a lot of us that do not get money from the Democratic Party, are not supported by the establishment, try to do our best. And one of the things I realized also is that sometimes campaigns, even when they go into our communities, whether they're going into the Latino community, African-American community, of course, none of our communities are monolithic. But they also start deciding who the good Latinos are, who the good Muslims are, who the good Black people are, you know, who are the right people. And anybody in our community who happens to be a little, you know, I'm trying to find the nice word.
Mouthy is the word.
A little spicy. You know, the spicy in our community, who really are
spicy,
the people,
spicy, yeah.
Spicy, feisty. Our little adversary to the Democratic Party. Yeah. Those are the people they want to marginalize, not knowing that those are the people, in fact, that they need, because those are the people that are going to bring you all the skeptics. Those are the people that are going to bring you all the young people. I mean, I'm telling you right now, my order is tall, because I promised all these people, I said, please just do the right thing. And I promise you, I'm going to get to the street and we're going to do this and I'm going to do that. And now I have all these things that I promised that I have to do, because people said, as long as people are going to fight with everything that they have for us,
right?
Fine, I'll suck it up and I'll do what is right. And that's what they did in Michigan, because Bernie had, you know, Trump won Michigan in 2016 by less than 10,000 votes. And there are over 100,000 registered Muslim American voters in Michigan who have not been touched by the campaign. They were being touched by organizers locally. And that's the people that were doing the work, because they knew it was the right thing to do, but it was not funded by the campaign. And so that's another thing, late, you know, because we're always late. Late, and we know this. And I broke quarantine back in May, and I was in Louisville, Kentucky. You could run a campaign and be safe, and you could do it with a mask, and you don't have to, you know, go. You could be 6 feet away. There were ways to do this, and all of a sudden, they realized they could do that in the last like week, you know, 3 weeks of the campaign, while organizers, Black and Brown organizers, were doing that throughout the last almost 4 months.
Yeah, and you know, Linda, like, major shout out to you, because you got. The campaign said pretty dismissive, disrespectful things about you, calming people down, saying you were going to have no role in the campaign. And like,
I said that, Kate, because people were like, when I started saying, you got to vote against Trump, we got to vote for Joe Biden, people started saying, oh, but Linda must be getting paid by the campaign, I must be selling out. And then all of a sudden, God intervened, Katie.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, some white man on the Biden campaign was like, this lady got nothing to do with our campaign.
Yeah.
I said, God is great, because I quoted that man and I started sending it out to all the progressive and leftists. Said, thank God. Trust me when I tell you, that was the best thing that ever happened to me.
Yeah. Too. Yeah. Seriously. It's like getting that, being smeared by someone like that is worth
it's
all
on
the
record.
Endorsement.
It's official that way. Yeah.
God. Yeah. It's like a positive endorsement from someone good. That was like when Alan Dershowitz was like, if Keith Ellison becomes a Democratic chair, I'm leaving the Democratic Party. And it's
like please.
Yeah, please. Like, that much more of a reason to root for Ellison, which that was a revealing moment for Obama, but I digress. What do you both think about how, and we'll get into this more with you, Linda, because Chuck has been very generous with his time, and we staggered you to have a cool conversation with some overlap. But what do you think can be done? I mean, we have a lot of skeptics in the chat, in the progressive community. A lot of people are just done. They're like, we're not moving him left. At the very best, we are like going to, maybe he'll go back into the climate accords. I mean, the way I see it right now is like certain terrible things that Trump did won't happen. Biden will do other terrible things, but the net result will be less destructive.
They're not going to like privatize the private parks anymore. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's not going to happen anymore.
Right. But how are we going to get, like, you know, the guy already said he'd veto Medicare for All if it came to him. So what is there to be done? Can anything be done?
Well, I think that we've got to, you know, start in the Congress. I think that Joe Biden is not going to be drafting any legislation, whether he signs it or not. If we put enough pressure, if Linda's folks put enough pressure, if the grassroots put enough pressure on him, he'll have to sign it. That's our job. That's what Bernie Sanders has said. Now, our first job is done. We got him. We got rid of Donald Trump. Now we hold these people accountable. You know, there's an immense amount of privilege in certain communities that say that they can just, walk away from this. No, this is just where the fight starts. Like, this is, we held Barack Obama accountable too. Like, there are things that have to happen. I've got half of my staff are immigrants. Half of my staff are currently working under DACA or TPS. That's real life shit for people. And I have to deal with that as a boss and as their friend and as some of their brothers and sisters. And so, like, I need that fixed now. Thank you, President Biden. Let's fix DACA. That's easy. Let's do TPS. That's easy. Now let's see what the next thing is that I'm going to press for. Let's stop privatizing. Let's shut down all the private prisons. Let's reunite these families at the border. Like, there are things incrementally. And then I'm going to dig into Congress with the groups that I work with to come up with something that I want done as far as what my folks, me, my family, my workers. Like, I come from this from a very unique perspective that I've been very, very poor. I know what government cheese tastes like. I've never been to college, right? I've got a criminal record, Katie. You know my story, right? Like, I'm not the stereotypical consultant. That's what I think makes me halfway decent, understanding uneducated brown men that we always talk about. How do you get to them? I'm like, well, maybe if you hired an uneducated brown man that's sitting right here, I could help you figure that out. I may not have all the answers, but I'll tell you what we don't like. But what we won't, just like a lot of these, all the progressives and all these woke white consultants, like, there's just, we've got to kind of dig in, and we all can play our role in holding all of our government accountable. And that's not some sellout. That means that, guess what's going to happen? Now, let me end with this. I don't want to take all of Linda's time, but we're fixing to go into a redistricting year. All these congressional districts are going to be much different. They're all going to have a lot of new people in it. And you're going to have a Congress now that's all going to run to the right, because they all are scared to death about Donald Trump just did by wiping them out in the House and the Senate. That's a unique opportunity for progressives to have the most unbelievable power that we've ever had, because these Democrats are also scared shitless that they're fixing to all get primary. I'm already talking to a lot of them. They're always already asking me what should they be doing, because they see us coming. And so that's just something to think about. Is don't forget our power that we have right now.
Yeah. Really quickly before you leave, Chuck, people wanted to know what you did time for, and also about the PAC, and they're saying what's the deal with the PAC, and what was Sanders' position on the PAC that you founded?
I created Nuestro PAC to create the Latino outreach right after the primary, because I had to have a vehicle to do that with. And if I create a C3 nonpartisan, I ain't nonpartisan. A C4 issue advocacy, I ain't about the issues. There's a lot of great groups doing issue. I want to beat bad people. So I created a super PAC. It's the only way I could do it. And I'm so happy I did it. Was the old man, excuse me, I shouldn't call the old man on camera. Was Bernie not happy?
That's my old man.
That's right.
All of our old man, yeah.
He wasn't as happy, but now he's like, Chuck, oh, we got to do something in Georgia. We can't just let them fuck this up. And I'm like, right. Oh, well, we could do something with, oh, that's what we could do. Well, I don't really like the super PACs. I'm like, well, I'm going to go down there and knock some Republicans in the teeth. Well, we should talk. So it's been great. We did $8 million. We've got a lot of organized labor money. I created a grassroots infrastructure. We had over 2,000 donors from grassroots activists. So I was super happy. And guess who was the only group talking to Latinos, Linda? In Michigan, Pennsylvania, Arizona, Wisconsin, was my super PAC. So I was pumped to be able to go in there and do that work. And I didn't have to ask nobody's permission. It could make my own ads.
That's right.
And right, the criminal record is 8 years ago, I got convicted of embezzling $485 at the Steelworkers Union. A white man would have got off from that. But I now have a federal felony on my record for just under $500 on a mess up on my expenses, God, where I shouldn't have put it on my corporate credit card. Fully accountable. Big mistake. But now I never went to jail, but I paid a fine and had to be on probation, federal probation for 24 months. So when you talk about criminal justice reform, I've lived it. I walked into my federal probation officers in Washington, D.C., and he said, why are you even here? I deal with real criminals. What judge would do this to you for $500? Who did you piss off?
Wow.
Anyway, you live and learn, and it makes me a better consultant every day.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you for joining us. Everyone should get
Linda.
The book.
Talk to you.
Yeah. Come back on and we'll talk more about the book and more in depth.
Yeah. Thank y'all so much.
Thank you. Linda, thank you. Everyone, if people are just tuning in, please like this stream, share the stream, subscribe by hitting subscribe, and then you press the bell. And also make sure you all follow Linda on Twitter right now at Al Sarsour. Linda, thank you so much for joining us. You're really one of the greatest organizers, I think. And really inspiring. And again, I really commend you for ignoring it's not that easy to hear people talk about you that way and then be knocking on the doors for them. Although I think, you know, it was to probably to defeat Trump more than it was to, mm-hmm. you know, but how did you deal with all the frustration? I mean, the Sanders campaign, and then the Biden campaign being punching left so much, and what are you going to do to bring the heat?
You know, I already knew this, how this was going to play out, unfortunately. You know, I was never really naive. I supported Bernie Sanders with everything that I had. You know, of course, I had those high moments when it seemed like we were about to, you know, clinch a nomination. But then the back of my mind, it just kept, that voice kept telling me, are you crazy? Do you really think the Democratic Party is going to let Senator Bernie Sanders become the nominee? So I wasn't as shocked and heartbroken as everybody else. It just reminded me of how much more work we have to do as progressives in the party. But really, I got to a point where I was like, look, I can't, you know, just sit around and allow Donald Trump to have four more years. You know, in the next 4 years, it would have been no holds barred in our people. And our people have been absolutely horrified and traumatized. Mm-hmm. Not to say that they already weren't before that, because, of course, as you know, I come from a community that in the last, at least since the immediate, you know, aftermath of the events of 9/11, my community has been traumatized by multiple, you know, foreign policy, domestic policy, you name it. And I had a feeling that, in my heart that said to me, like, they deserve more than that. And Joe Biden wasn't going to be much more, but he was going to be definitely not Donald Trump. And I know that doesn't seem inspiring to people, and it wasn't inspiring to me, but I was able to reframe the conversation. So when I went into Muslim communities, when I talked to young people, I was predominantly organizing in Muslim American communities. And then I was also on a state of emergency tour with a bus full of Black organizers. I was the only not Black organizer on that bus. So we went to Durham, North Carolina, specifically focused there. We went to Gate City in Alabama, which is in Birmingham. It's basically the projects, the Sojourner Truth Houses in North Detroit, places that, you know, not everybody goes multiple times, or maybe don't go at all. We like to go to, as they say, to the hood, to the places where the Democratic Party says these communities are low propensity voters. They're not that important. We're going to go focus our efforts somewhere else. And so for me, I just basically told everyone, look, I just need a better opponent in the White House. That's all I'm asking you for. I'm not asking you for to vote for the best thing that ever happened to us. I'm asking you to give me somebody better, somebody where we don't have to be only reactive, that we can really build proactive movement under, that we can really push somebody to the left, because we weren't pushing Trump anywhere. That's just the bottom line. I think what Trump did do for our movement is that he did galvanize many more people than we've ever had in the movement. But to say that somehow over the last 4 years we pushed Trump to the left would be idiotic, because that really didn't happen.
Right.
And so I'm, you know, you already know me. I've been a small Democrat, a small letter D Democrat, only because I want to engage in primaries. But other than that, I don't have any loyalty to the Democratic Party. I never did. I never believed that the Democratic Party had loyalty in the way that it is set up right now. And ever since Keith Ellison, you know, that seat was stolen from him, that was when I really was like, nah, this Democratic Party really ain't for me. And only until Senator Bernie Sanders ran under the Democratic ticket did I start really feeling like I could get in this. Because, you know, Katie, we're in New York. I voted down the Working Families Party line in New York. So I don't really need to be a Democrat in New York unless I want to engage in primaries here. Right. But, you know, here we are. And now so much more work is left to be done.
We had on Joshua Kahn Russell, who's an organizer who, you know, sings your praises. And that's, you know, one of the things he was saying is like, he's similar. It's like, I'm not a Democrat. Bernie was the exception. I was excited to vote for him. And I was excited by his campaign, but this is about, showing like changing the terrain that we're fighting on. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like I think it's really important to remember this. And like, that's why I think you do have a lot of cred, because you just called out Obama for intervening in stealing an election from like the first Black Muslim congressman, and giving it to Tom Perez, who like no one even knew what the hell to vote for him for, except for Obama's people making phone calls.
I knew Tom Perez before when he worked at the administration. He was like a regular guy, worked in the Department of Labor, worked at the Department of Justice, and we used to see him in meetings and stuff, but there was really nothing extraordinary about him.
Yeah.
Grassroots. No one knew who he was. He wasn't going to. The point of the DNC chairmanship really is, you really have one job, and your job is to galvanize Democratic voters across the country. Your job is to fundraise and to excite and to help shape the narrative of what the Democratic Party reflects. And Keith Ellison was Black. He was Muslim. He was a true progressive.
Yeah.
He's beloved amongst many parts of the movement, even amongst the establishment Democrats. He was part of the Progressive Caucus, the Congressional Black Caucus. I mean, he had every credential. I mean, I can't think of a credential that he did not actually possess. And unfortunately, it was stolen from him at a time where we needed him the most. Because I truly believe that if Keith Ellison was the chairman of the DNC, we would have had an either Bernie Sanders or an Elizabeth Warren nomination.
Well, that's why they did it, right?
Well, listen, I'm not naive to the politics of those who are comfortable and want to stay that way. I mean, I don't know if this is a rumor, but I read this article like literally right before I got on, Katie, and I literally almost fell out, where I read an article that said that there are sources that are saying that the Biden administration has offered or is in talks with Mitt Romney on Secretary of Health and Human Services. And I literally was like, I'm already getting trolled and it hasn't even been like
28
hours, you know? Right. So I hope people who are celebrating, and I don't want to take that away from people, Katie, because there are a lot of people who are just like you and me who are little in the street, like left their families behind 16-hour days. And they have the right and the opportunity to say we defeated fascism and we've defeated Trump and they should be able to celebrate. Mm-hmm. But I'm letting you know that should be really temporary because I'm already getting trolled.
I think just yesterday. I think only yesterday. Yesterday was enough.
I mean, I saw people in the street and you saw Brooklyn. Brooklyn was lit. Yeah. But I was like, I'm not there yet. I don't know what it is. Maybe
I saw a lot of people celebrating and I was like, you know, maybe you guys shouldn't have the Biden flags. I was like, you don't want the photos with the Biden flags for a couple of years from now. You're going to want to like remember this and not like be annoyed about it. You shouldn't have like the Biden flag out right now.
Just have like Trump with the X.
Have Trump stuff. The American flag is even fine if you must have some flag, you know.
I mean, I'm in Bay Ridge. You better believe I wasn't running outside with no flags.
He's just trying to pitch to.
I was in West Hollywood and I just saw people.
People in my district, as you know, where I am in New York, we lost the congressional seat here. We lost our, we had a state Senate seat that's still in counting right now, which is Senator Andrew Gonardis from the New York State Senate. And then we lost our congressional seat to, you know, Max Rose lost his seat, which, by the way, I did not lift a finger. I did nothing. Absolutely zero. Call me selfish. But Max Rose was absolutely outrageous. And I know that someone more outrageous than him is now going to Congress. But she will be a lame duck congresswoman. She will have no power in a Democratic majority house. But she will run her mouth and she will troll Ilhan and Rashida and AOC. And she can knock herself out.
Right.
Hopefully in 2022, we'll come back and, you know, hopefully we'll have someone that's truly progressive and someone who could really galvanize and inspire our district.
Right. As opposed to like a Trump support. I mean, he was a Trumpian Democrat.
I remember one time. Well, first of all, he also went up against Ilhan coming from a district with one of the largest Muslim American communities in the whole entire New York State. That was one. And then I remember there was some bill around, not a bill, it was like a bill or a resolution or something about anti-Semitism or something. And, you know, and that's fine. You could vote for that and whatever. And it was, some sort of non-binding resolution. Right. But the fact that you felt the need to go stand next to Trump when he signed it, just at that, that was when I was like, no, I'm not doing that. If you're already stand next to like, you know, literally neo-Nazis or people who support neo-Nazis, I'm just not going to do that anymore.
Yeah.
The Muslims were like, we're not doing that.
Yeah. Also, like, how dumb are you or opportunistic to think that Trump is is anti-Semitic?
Yeah, I mean that's the other thing. So I wasn't even
right
as a community. We weren't even mad at him for the actual resolution.
Right.
But you're literally letting a guy who supports neo-Nazis, people, and you and by the way, Max Rose is Jewish, right? And you go hand with Donald Trump, and the Muslims were like, we're not doing that. And so he lost his seat. And I think that goes to what's happening now online, Katie, people, you know, trolling AOC for being, you know, a truth teller and for saying it like it is and making you reckon with who you are. Everybody who was supporting Medicare for All around the country kept their seat or won their seat, right? It was those that actually were centrists are the ones that lost their seat. Like Max Rose was no progressive losing his seat. That's clear to everybody. And so I think my frustration right now is like, it's like, it's like you got to slap them in the head with it. I'm like, I don't know how much more we have to do and who to do.
It's right.
Like these progressive right. issues, like Medicare for All is one of the most popular issues in America across the aisle. And I don't know how to keep, I don't know how to get that through their head.
I agree with Chuck that it's like it just that we have to do it like at the ground level. Basically, it's like basically having the argument with these people is not going to work. So we need to replace them. You know yeah. what I mean? It's like oh, yeah, frankly, the way I've been thinking about it is I'm like, man, establishment Democrats don't have any up and comers. All they have is like super old people that like have a built in Q rating like Joe Biden. You know what I mean? Like there are people that like people already know about and like have feelings for or whatever, but they have no bench and they have no young rising stars. So we need to build a bench, and we also need to stop any neoliberal rising star. We need to Joe Kennedy all of them. Truly, we need to destroy them like in politics forever.
For destroying Joe Kennedy, I don't even know what to say about that.
Yeah, right
now. You know, listen, hey, the guy listened to the young people.
I mean, he did.
And that's why he won.
Right.
I think what I'm worried about, Jack and Katie, is 4 years from now, these young people that we took to the polls, trust me when I tell you, if I dare come back and mm-hmm. say, please, you know, just this one time, do the, you know, vote for this person. If the nominee in 2024 is not a true progressive, those young people, that's where my credibility will just go down the toilet. Like, I'm not going to be able to come back with any face to try to beg people and say, okay, this last time it wasn't the lesser of two evils. Last time it was like fascist, not fascist. So that's right. The case, yeah. Then 2024 comes along. I'm not going to go back to 2016, which was the lesser of the two evils at the time. We didn't know how evil Trump would be, but we were expecting him to be pretty evil. And
the problem is that it might end up being another Trump, even. You know, it could end up being another equally evil. And it's like, well, we've used all this capital now, and, you know, people aren't going to believe it again. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, right now, people think, oh, well, we won this election not by a landslide. And people think that the conservatives and the Republicans are just sitting at home right now. They're already organizing against us. And that's what they did in 2008. We elected Obama. They all got hunkered down in their basements. They started organizing their people on a very grassroots level, people we never heard of. And then all of a sudden, boom, I get Congressman Michael Grimm in my district. You know, these are the people that ran on the Tea Party. There's going to be Tea Party times 10. Because they've actually have built the bench over the last few years, right? They do have a bench now. And they kind of showed us what they were made of. Like, they didn't really get, I mean, if anything, if Donald Trump leaves with any little, you know, he's going to come out and probably say this eventually when he figures out that he really, really lost.
Yeah.
He's going to say, I lost, but I didn't get my ass kicked. And
for sure. That's kind of what he's already saying. Yeah.
I mean, well, right now he's saying he didn't lose.
Yeah. Right. But emphasizing how well he did as an incumbent.
Yesterday he tweeted most votes ever for a sitting president. And I was like, oh, that's what the line is going to be. Yeah. That's like them setting up the line is most votes ever for a sitting president.
Yeah, he's not lying.
Yeah, that's the truth.
More Republicans voted for him this time than they did in 2016. So somehow he expanded the electorate. Mm-hmm. Like that's what he did.
I mean, it's so funny. Everybody was crowing about Joe Biden got the most votes. He beat Obama's record. And then I'm like, but then Trump beat it the next day. Like Trump also beat Obama's 2008 record, you know, if that for an idea of how meaningful that is. You know what I mean?
Like they're just telling half the story. And I'm just like, okay, fine. You're right. Joe Biden got a whole lot of votes and, you know, they owed to the organizers in the street that made that happen.
But what you said is right. Why
is the Lincoln Project not being like run out of town? They didn't deliver. They lost Republicans. Like they had one job, and yet MSNBC is treating them like negative. They saved. Yeah,
they gave us negative Republicans. Like not even no Republicans. Negative.
Right. We lost. Yeah.
And well, Wilson is online talking about, you know, why are people trolling me right now? Because I have work to do. I'm focused on Georgia. No, you need to get out of Georgia. In Georgia. I will pay you.
Yeah, let's pay. Yeah.
I'll pay you not to go to Georgia.
We'll send you another Confederate flag wrapped ice beer cooler. Do you see this? Have you seen this?
Oh, yeah. Rick Wilson posted an Instagram a long time ago that has a Confederate flag on a cooler that says the South will rise again. No, so this is the new like Democrat, you know, this is their guy now.
Yeah. Lord have mercy. A guy who said terrible things about like, I mean, such racist things. Offensive things. I mean, I'm not an Ann Coulter fan, but he said to her, like, does Trump pay more for anal?
Something about Muslims, really
Islamophobic stuff about like and crude also like at the same time
is that other neoliberal supporters or like some of those like centrist Democrats are like, why are you all pulling up his old little tweets? Like that's, we gotta, and I'm like, why don't, I was like, well, I didn't see you say that about everybody else's old tweets that you put up.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Yeah. And also, what's the deal with all this like civility? It's time to come together, except for we're going to say how this is all the fault of leftists and AOC and Medicare for all.
It's really like, I'm telling you, I'm like watching a whole like movie like happen. Like, I'm like, is this real life, people? Like, do you not, even the people praising, like, for example, when Joe Biden went up yesterday and he said, you know, I appreciated that he did this where he kind of says specifically, it's the African-American, you know, vote that kind of helped put me over.
Right.
But it required Black organizers to organize the Black vote.
Right.
When you talk about the Latino community coming out, or you talk about any community, it requires organizers to organize the people. And then the thing again about it is the people who are organizing, the ones who I saw in the street in every city that I went to, were literally people like, in Georgia, those women that are organizing, that organize under the kind of umbrella of Stacey Abrams, or the ones that organize the New Georgia Project, these are abolitionists. These are the defund the police. These are the Medicare for all. These are like abolish ICE. You know, this is the kind of ideology of the organized, the New Florida Majority, you know, the folks that were organizing on Amendment 4, the Dream Defenders Action. You know, when you look at Con Mi Gente, or you look at literally every group that was on the streets, that was organizing, Black Voters Matter. I mean, all of the folks. These are people who are, when if we want to, maybe they don't call themselves leftists, but ideologically, on the issues, they are all progressive leftists.
Yeah.
And Malika, apparently it's our fault.
Right. It's the same people's fault who got him in. Or that it's, yeah, it's ridiculous. And like Malika Jabali was on, who's a great journalist, who, and she's been in Wisconsin. And she was saying, she was like, I was watching all these working class Black volunteers, like working their butts off, getting up since dawn, doing all this door knocking just for Biden to tell them, like, I may veto Medicare for all if it comes to my desk, even though in this state, like it's totally disproportionately affecting Black people. One of like the biggest discrepancies in terms of COVID is totally disproportionately affecting them. It's just, it's really, I don't know.
The results of the election are so bizarre. Democrats did find a way to win the presidency. They did. And I agree with Linda that I think a lot of that is because of, you know, organizing and, you know, people doing sort of filling in for what the Biden campaign refused to do, which was have any kind of ground game at all during the entire election. But they managed to find a way to win where they lost in almost every measurable way. You know, we lost seats in the House. We didn't take the Senate, like, you know, and already, you know, the knives are out blaming the left for saying defund the police or whatever. But as you mentioned, Linda, it's like the people that lost were all centrist Democrats. And so it's like, you know, obviously, like, it's good that Trump lost and a second Trump term would have been truly evil.
Yeah, exactly. Make it make sense. Yeah. I mean, OK, so Joe Biden, by the way, but Joe Biden, no Biden honeymoon.
No honeymoon Biden.
Before we move on to that, not to be petty, but let's just be a little feisty and spicy, because this is cathartic. And look, like, Linda, again, she deserves so much credit for not like snubbing the campaign after they were so terrible to her. But let's just look at because I think it's important to have a sense of what we're dealing with. Again, this is Rick Wilson. So I went on this little thread. Oh, this is my hot take. I said, I think the left should expose how evil the Lincoln Project and some of Biden's potential cabinet picks are, and help Ossoff and Warnock defeat.
Hey, by the way, good take, because, you know, that kind of is what has been going on. You know what I mean? It's like the focus, from AOC and other folks has been like, hey, fuck the Lincoln Project. Get them out like immediately. Yeah. We're done now. Like,
we are done now. And so now this is in addition to organizing what I do outside of electoral politics. To people, I mentioned saying it's Trumpian Manichaean to call Lincoln Project and cabinet evil. You're right. I should have been more precise. There's Confederate flag waving evil. And this is Rick Wilson, just so you guys can see.
Yeah.
This is a photo of, you see that cooler, the wine cooler with the South will rise again. And then this is just, this is dog cruelty. Like, how dare you put your dog in that photo.
Oh, wow. They put a dog in the photo with the cooler?
Yeah.
That's so sad.
That's a cute dog.
Yeah, it's so cute, right? I know. That dog deserves better. Yeah. And then we have, of course, the Meg Whitman evil who, I mean, she is just like, remember she had an undocumented nanny who she found out about it? And then, like, it breaks my heart, but she should be deported, which is just so cruel. Like, it's bad on both ends. And then, but I think one of my favorites really is Kasich, who, I mean, he's so bad. Like, he's so bad. He passed one of the worst abortion bills that had no exceptions for rape or incest. Oh, here it is. By the way, Linda, you said he said some anti-Muslim stuff. Here's the deal. I don't care. This is back to Rick Wilson. I don't care what flavor of Islam these dicks are. The flavor, the need is to be is bleeding out of a hole in their temple.
Jesus. Holy crap. No, Rick Wilson is like truly a vile, like actually a really vile racist Republican. Like that Rick Wilson, you know, appears on MSNBC, which ostensibly at this point is like, is it more Republicans? Like, I'm like with him and like, you know, Nicole Wallace and shit. I'm like, this looks like I'm watching fucking Fox.
Bill Crystal.
I mean, Kasich for me is the worst of them all. And I'll tell you why. I mean, during the DNC convention, if you remember, they gave him a platform.
Yeah.
They literally put him on a main platform. And what was crazy to me was if you watch the DNC, you would not think that we had an Ilhan Omar or a Rashida. There was actually an ode to women. I don't know if you saw that. It was like a segment about women in the DNC. And it was funny because they had just disavowed and they said, oh, we disavow Linda's views, which of course specifically were about my views on Palestine and the boycott, divestment, sanctions movement, which is basically disavowing 99.8% of the people in my community, which is put that to the side. Yeah. But then they did this ode to women and it started with me. I was in the video. Like, you're doing an ode to women because it started with the women's march and I'm in the footage of it. So like you see me in the footage, but then they start showing clips of like when, you know, women were winning office around the country and that kind of surprise, like, oh my God, I won. And it was so inspiring. And they were going from woman to woman to woman. And all of a sudden at the end, I'm like, well, what about that Somali black Muslim woman from Minnesota? Or what about the Palestinian Muslim one from Michigan, from two important states that you all need to win in this election? And so the fact that they erased Ilhan and Rashida from the convention, what they did to me, the fact that they won Michigan and Minnesota is because of the very women that you try to marginalize in the campaign. But then you would give platform to Kasich, to your point, who is anti-women, anti-immigrant. I mean, some of the worst things that I could think of have been done at the hands of this man in his state, and he didn't even win the state for you. Like, on top of
that, right? It's not even justifiable from a strategic, like, forget the morality of it. It's not even strategically justifiable.
Yeah, it was not strategic at all. Like, when I went to speak at the DNC convention, I was invited by the Muslim delegation for the DNC. Like, to be clear, folks, I'm a delegate to the DNC. Like, it wasn't like a random situation. I'm a DNC delegate. I ran in my district and I won. Just like everybody else, it was fair. Nobody paid me to be a delegate. I didn't pay nobody. I didn't bribe anybody. I won because people in my district voted for me. And so when I went to speak, I didn't even want to speak because I was worried that people would say I was selling out. Why was I going to the DNC? But I said, you know what? They need a voice like mine. So when I got invited, I went. And so my thing is like, you actually strategically need voices like ours because we are the ones that bring credibility to the table. Because if you want to try to bring the party together, it's not they that bring the party together. We bring the party together. Even Bernie, to be quite honest with you, people were so hurt by him kind of conceding or kind of, you know, whatever the word is, leaving the race early.
Yeah.
But there were a lot of people mad at Bernie too. So we had to step in for Uncle Bernie, like, all right. The amount of times I defended Bernie over him leaving the race and being like, don't worry, he got a strategy. There's, you know, he's playing checkers or whatever, he's playing chess. And and it's just the strategy behind it. And then Kasich is running. And then after he loses Ohio for us, he's still on television running his mouth.
It's
not a pre thing. It's a post for a loser.
He should be labeled loser Kasich.
Loser of Ohio has some opinions about how to win. Like,
Come on.
Yeah. So they can't even, I mean, this is all because they actually want, this is, you know, it goes back to the Thomas Frank Listen Liberal thesis, which is that the Dems just want, a lot of them just want the bad stuff and they pretend that they're being forced into it, which is why I do want us to win the Senate, because if only, and then all these people are like, you neoliberal shill, blah, blah, blah. I'm sure you get this too, Linda, but it's like, I want the Dems to win the Senate because at the very least it'll expose them when they're not moving left. They're not going to be able to say it's because of like obstruction.
Yeah, now we're just trapped in this hellish thing where we're going to ping pong back and forth. It seems like every 4 years. It really is it feels like we might get a lot more single terms if this is kind of like the way things are going to ping pong and with the way obstruction is working in D.C.
I mean, what I do know about Georgia is I actually know Raphael Warnock personally. He's actually, me and him are in seminary together.
Oh, great.
I've gotten to know him on a personal level. He's incredible. He really is.
Yeah.
You know, somebody that I believe is going to fight
on the show.
He's a great human being. Ossoff, I don't know. He's not right. Someone.
Yeah, Warnock does seem amazing. To be clear, sorry, he seems amazing. I'm saying like even people who don't believe in the Democrats anymore. And yes, I mean Ossoff is not the inspiring guy. I think that Warnock is, but he's running against, is it Purdue or Loft? One of those two
horrible. They're both running.
I think he's Purdue.
Horrific,
I think. Horrific human beings. Like
like almost like
Loeffler is like cartoonishly evil. Yeah. The guy that runs the New York Stock Exchange. He's doing ads of like kill journalists and shit. It's like just a cartoon.
Yeah. So Linda, what do you need from us? Like, what do organizers need right now? What are you doing? What kind of support or I don't know. Yeah. Tell us what you need.
So like I said earlier, when Chuck was on, you know, we made some promises, Katie, and I'm a woman of my word, and the people I organize with are people of their word. So I can't indulge too much today, but know that Biden will be met with mobilization and that he's not just going to stroll into the White House like everything's going back to normal. He's already trolling us. I'm reading a lot of articles about potential picks and nominees for cabinet positions. A lot of people are saying, oh, well, the Republicans are not going to let him. It doesn't matter what the Republicans do, because just like the Donald Trump administration had interim everybody, Biden can have interim everybody. And so for me, the work starts today. So we've been already organizing. There have been already many meetings and Zoom calls just within the last 36 hours, getting the progressive movement coordinated. I don't have to agree with everybody. You don't all have to like me, but we have to ensure that this administration understands that you are not our enemy yet. We are going to treat you as the president of the United States of America, who was elected by the people, and the people are going to hold you accountable. What we do know is even if we do not win back the Senate, there are many things that the Biden administration can do and has the authority to do. And they have already said some of the things that they are willing to do, which to Chuck's point, I commend them for, but are also the easy things to do, like the reinstatement of DACA, the temporary protective status, even the repealing of the Muslim ban, which of course means a lot to people in my community and those I organize with, things around, canceling student debt. There's just many, 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 getting back into the Paris Accord. I mean, there's a lot of things. And so they've named some of the things that they are ready to do. And to be clear, I hope that everybody understands that they didn't just wake up one morning and be so profound and be like, oh my God, I have some great things. It is what we have done as a movement, is that they knew when they went in there that they were running in the general election, they had to make those commitments because the movement needed them to make commitments in order for us to do the work that we did during the election. So we will be meeting Joe Biden and Kamala with mass mobilization. We will continue to hold them accountable. And we hope that those who have been organizing with us, particularly our white allies, many of whom may have been progressive and cared about the issue, but were not, in fact, as engaged on the street as they were before the Donald Trump administration, that you stay on the streets. Because actually what I'm telling those people now is there wasn't really much a product that we got out of our mobilization. We were not able to stop the tax scam bill. We were not able to stop some of the healthcare cuts. I mean, there wasn't much that we could do. We were not able to, save these children at the border. I mean, there's still 545 children whose parents we have no idea where they went. But what I do believe is going to happen under a Biden administration is that those same people who've been organizing that mass mobilization we've maintained over the last 4 years, you're going to actually see some fruits of our labor. It's not going to be all the fruits, but it'll be some. And I think that's what makes this what moved me to want to defeat a Donald Trump administration. I wanted to see something, Katie. I was 4 years. I'm exhausted. I saw nothing. I didn't get anything. I lost the Muslim ban case in the Supreme Court. I was loss after loss. Neighbors reported. I mean, everything was happening around us. And you know, for me, this next 4 years, I'm actually looking really forward to it because I think that we're going to be able to set it up well, more so for 2024. I think the progressives are going to have the kind of ground zero these 4 years to actually build movements that are going to outlast and get us into 2024 and then 2026.
Yeah. And what about any, what do you think of the People's Party or a third party? I know that's not really your lane because you're an organizer more into, and you happen to, you know, like we all did, fall in love with Amo Bernie. But any thoughts on that and whether, I mean, just as like a threat?
I mean, I think just so you know, I mean, there are people in the movement that are already in this conversation. I mean, a third party is a long-term commitment. You can't just wake up one morning and say you need a third party. I mean, this is about getting signatures on the ballots in 50 states. It has to be a 50-state strategy. There has to be resources and money behind it. And I'm not ruling it out. Like I said, if 2024 comes around and we get stuck in a situation where we have some outrageous Republican and some centrist neoliberal Democrat, I'm letting you know right now, those young people are not going to the polls.
Yeah.
It's just not going to happen. And so that's going to require us to kind of get into a space where we're going to have to think really quickly. Yeah. Not to say that people are not already going to start doing that, some of that work right now, but I still see the potential of an AOC type party over the next 4 years. If the progressives stay uniform and stay together, I've said this before, Katie, and I tell this to progressives all the time. Unity is not uniformity. And I want the progressives to understand that we can never be at the table where all of us are going to agree on every single issue. You know, some people in the movement, as you know, are abolitionists. Some people are not yet there, but we can still figure out how to organize in this moment together. You know, so that's what I'm looking forward to. We've already had some really positive conversations just in the last few days. And so hopefully in the next week or so, we'll kind of be putting more public plans out there, like what we're expecting. You know, how we get to the streets together, where are we going to be in the streets together? Because Joe Biden, I'm going to give them their space. Let them go celebrate. Yeah. You got the first Black woman to be the vice president. She's the first woman of color to be vice president. And I understand how monumental that is, just as it was monumental 2008 Obama.
Right.
And I think it's important that Black women also organize that. They basically told Joe Biden, it better be a Black woman that you're getting that vice presidential ticket. And that's what he did because he was organized into doing that. It also wasn't something that he woke up with one day and was like, I'm going to put a Black woman. Right. He was pressured in by the very, I say, amazing organizing that Black women did around that particular thing. So anything that has happened that anybody wants to commend, just remember, it was organizers and people that made those things happen.
Right. Not like a change of heart or Biden becoming
know about no changes
intersectional
of heart,
or something. Yeah.
No.
Well, definitely like come back on. You can give us an organizer update so we can know what to be demanding or how we can support you. Cause this is like, you know, and give people can celebrate. And we also like Linda knows this more than anyone else, because it's not like you were born into this movement. Like you stumbled into it recently. It's not like you think Obama saved us. You know, like, this is from the perspective of someone who's been fighting, organizing, and does not think that like all we have to do is get rid of Trump and then we can brunch and revel in democracy.
I mean, I've been telling people, actually, you know, you already know this, Katie. I wrote a book. And
yes, which is really good. Everyone should read
my book, you know, obviously during the Trump administration, but I was very specific to my publishers that I'm not writing about Trump. I've been organizing for almost 2 decades under Republican and Democratic administrations. And every single issue that I've organized on, Katie, I've organized under both administrations.
Right.
Healthcare, I've organized around ending unwarranted surveillance. I've worked on foreign policy issues and anti-war issues, literally under both administrations. So for me, I want people to remember that if you can choose any issue, criminal justice, immigration, issues around foreign policy, war with Iran, Palestine, you name it. These are issues that literally transcend political parties.
Yeah.
So don't feel like because there is now no Trump in the White House that somehow all the injustice around us has disappeared. In fact, what's going to happen is that I think that police unions across the country, the police shootings that we've seen on literally almost on a daily basis, and sometimes, you know, sometimes two in a day in some parts of the country. Sometimes we hear about that. We got to stay focused. We got to stay consistent. And we have to let Joe Biden know that he works for us. And that's what I keep telling people when I went to people's doors on local down ballot races. What I said to people is, we are the employer. So now everyone's saying, we fired you, Trump, and we hired you, Joe Biden. And you know what? Joe Biden works for the American people. And so the American people also include progressives and include people that care about healthcare. Like, I don't understand, Katie, why we're still in the moment. And we one day we'll come back and have an answer to this question, why it's so radical for us to say that everybody deserves healthcare. Yeah. Or why we say things like, stop killing Black people. You know, I don't know, like nothing, I don't believe anything we're saying is so out of like bound with just humanity and and just basic dignity for people.
Right. Yeah, no, I mean, it's unbelievable. The thing, one of the things that bothers me so much about the DNC talking about structural racism is like, so you know it's there, and then you have this tool, Medicare for All, that can deal, not, and that's the other thing I hate, it's not going to end racism. No one's, literally no one's ever saying with the stroke of the pen, you're going to end racism. If you have Medicare for All, racism goes away. No one's saying that. But to pretend that there's not a relationship between Medicare for All and racism is absurd. And they know this because they keep saying that it's disproportionately, COVID is disproportionately affecting people of color. So it's just, yeah, I mean, it is. It's on, it's, and one of the great things Sanders did is he made it clear that these ideas that people have presented, like you were saying, as like fringe, radical, scary, you know, oh, or maybe like they're good ideas, but it's too soon, people aren't ready for them. No, they're ready for them.
Right now.
Right now, yeah.
Yeah, which makes you wonder why they don't run on them. Maybe it's like the people that finance some of these campaigns, you know?
Yeah. Maybe if you run on them, you win. Like we just proved, like, I think it was like 19 out of 24
we got
Democratic Socialist candidates. Right. Like, I'm telling you, somebody has to help make it make sense. There has to be a translator for like this neoliberal, like, blind, like color blindedness, issue blindedness, and just everything blindedness. It's as if we're, as if they're watching something happen through a different
room
than we are. Like everybody's watching this. All the people that supported Medicare for All won their races.
Yeah.
It was those who did not, that did not win those races. And I don't know how much more simple than that you could explain this.
Well, I think this is, I mean, just to that point, reading this tweet belatedly that is up on the screen, and, you know, I said this is a joke prediction we made about what a Republican light Biden would be, but it's even worse than I imagined or we imagined. And that's Andrew Solander tweeted out per Politico, for front runners for Biden cabinet include state Susan Rice, AG Doug Jones, as in Alabama loser, HHS Michelle Lujan Grisham, transport Eric Garcetti, commerce Meg Whitman. Man. Meg Whitman, who like
Garcetti and Whitman is truly, that's unbelievable.
And also remember, like okay. Susan Rice is a hawk and she'll be terrible as Secretary of State. But there was a time when Democrats, like, that's understandable and unfortunate, something we have to fight against because war is bad and militarism is bad. And she blamed George Floyd protests on Russians. On Russia. So whatever.
Yeah, she's a conspiracy theorist. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
Lord have mercy.
But like there was a time when Meg Whitman and Kasich were not welcomed. Like that, like Dems knew like they weren't going to be running with, you know, they'd be running against Meg Whitman. But and I guess Kasich isn't on the list. He's just become a spokesman for this.
Yeah, I mean, these could change. Not that they're changing for the better. But Health and Human Services, I guess the other person in the running is Mitt Romney.
Yeah.
And I look at, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, because I might be wrong. Is Heitkamp, we're talking about Senator Heitkamp. Is she
Heidi Heitkamp,
She also voted for Brett Kavanaugh. Like, I'm just like on a whole other, you know, situation here. I mean, I can't even, I mean,
I'll say as someone from Los Angeles that I actually the Eric Garcetti transport pick because he won't be our mayor anymore happens. Hey, so, you know, there are, you know, silver linings.
About somebody was trying to offer Andrew Cuomo a cabinet seat. And I said, listen, I'm not wrong, Katie.
Yeah, take him.
I'm good.
I want to see as long as he'll make some more posters about how he defeated COVID.
Listen, take them all. I'm good with it. I mean, again, you know, these are the kinds of things that I think are important, and which is very sad because we are kind of politically inclined people. So we kind of understand who these people are and what their story is. But the average American people who go to the polls do not know a lot about these people. So they might be looking at this and saying, sounds like some smart people names. I don't know, you know, it sounds like somebody did their homework about it. And this is, in fact, what all progressives were saying. Like the people that helped you win, I did not see a single progressive in that whole transition team.
No.
I did not see any of these people, none of these people that you have listed political. I read another article from another news site about some other predictions, not one. And it's just like, I'm already getting trolled. But you know what, Katie, I need that, because in order for us as progressives to mobilize the people on the street, I have to be like, I told you so.
Right.
Here it is, right there.
I told you.
Now let's get to the street.
Yeah. Well, yes, some Chomsky is my homeboy, right? Linda is fantastic by her book, which is very true. Really recommend that. It's a great book. It's very, what's the word? Rich, like personal, moving, all that stuff. Yeah.
Appreciate
you. Yeah. And yeah, you should be our organizer, or what is it? The Katie Halper Show's organizer in chief, resident organizer.
You got it. You got it.
Yeah. And also, we didn't even talk about this. We'll have to talk about this later, but another time, because I know you're extremely busy. And I'm also like super grateful that you came on, because you're an organizer. Plus, you have a family. It's like,
I got two cats, Katie.
Yeah.
Yeah. I went to Costco today, Katie.
How was it?
I pushed the cart in Costco, and I was looking around like I'm a normal person in Costco, and I felt really great.
Wow. You know, I just realized, was it with you, Jack? I just realized that Costco, like someone said Costco, because we all say Costco, but it has cost in it. Like,
oh, you didn't know that?
I never realized that.
Wow.
It's New Yorkers. We exactly.
We didn't realize that. Unless you're saying cost, I couldn't hear it.
It was funny because Costco was the last time I was in Costco, believe it or not, was when I was doing petition signatures for Bernie. And I was with my mom in Costco, and I was getting signatures in the Costco line at Costco. And my mother was like, okay, lady, listen, I'm with it. Bernie too. People are trying to shop at Costco. And in fact, I went to the one in Sunset Park in Brooklyn, and you should have saw me. I came back out. I took a picture, posted it online. Costco is the place to go get some petition signatures. Let me
really?
Tell
you. Really?
All right. Oh, yeah. Listen. Yeah. I came out with about four sheets.
What about BJ's and Sam's?
I'm not a BJ Sam kind of girl. Those are a little more far out from me. I'm close to Costco around here.
Yeah. Yeah, I hear you. Yeah. I was just trying to figure out a way to, you know, send I want other people with different tastes to be able to do their petitioning there. next time you're on, I want to talk to you about like the interesting Muslim Jewish Bernie. It's like so cool that there's such an affinity. And I mean, as a progressive leftist Jew, it's really nice to be able to point to Sanders. Like I used to, because I'm not religious, but I'm very, my Jewish background has really informed me. And I used to say when people would ask me, I was a Woody Allen Jew, but that's not a good reference for many reasons. And now, right? Like problematic. So then I got Bernie. So for selfish reasons, one of the other reasons I love him, not just because I love his politics and how, like, I love his accent. He sounds like one of my family members, but, or it could sound like one of your family members, Linda, honestly. I mean, your cousin's age, I think, probably, like your generation. It's like really great that it's amazing watching him be better on that issue than any other senator.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just going to say this because I know other people here who are in our kind of ideological wave. Like, I'm not going to lie to you. What I felt in the last weekend is more so I was just feeling so sad. Like, I was happy a little bit. I was like, yes, we defeated the fascists, something to be proud of. And no one should take that away from us, the movement, or from our communities, particularly marginalized people. But I'm so sad. When I look at Senator Bernie Sanders, there's this one photo that somebody posted. I don't remember who it was. It might have been Sean King. But it's a photo of, like, little Bernie Sanders. He's really small. He's like really far away in a picture. It looks like he's about to get on stage somewhere to do an event for Biden. And I just look at him and say, like, all the things that this guy has done, the political risks he has taken, the amount of times that he has came out on a limb. And one of the things I will never forget about him, Katie, is that in the darkest moments that Ilhan, Rashida, and I have had, Uncle Bernie Sanders picks up that phone. You know, Uncle Bernie, one time I remember during a really, really traumatic time for Ilhan, he literally went all the way back to Washington, D.C., where she was, and went out to dinner. He took her to dinner, like to be in a place with her. She had
posted. That's really touching.
That's who he is. And I remember when I was with him, there's a photo that I posted also of him when I went to Michigan for a primary, rally with Rashida. I was just standing, it was like at a high school, and I was just standing in the hallway. I was talking to somebody else, and he just came up to me, and you could tell by the picture where he has me like from my neck, like around my neck, like being like, how you holding up, kid? You doing well? You doing good? Like trying to give me a pep talk. And I'm like, who are you? Like, why
are
you so magnificent and remarkable and amazing and so wonderful and human? But anyway, so I've been sending messages to the whole Sanders family, particularly to Uncle Bernie, saying we love you. And we would not really have gotten here without him.
I mean,
he put his differences aside. He knew what the more smart marginalized people were going to be heard even more. And that's what he reaffirmed once again, who he is and what he stands for. And to know that in the history books are going to write about how overwhelmingly the Muslim American community in the United States of America, I'm talking about like 95%, were in support of Bernie Sanders. And the one thing that one day I'll send you a video of this, Katie, there was he came to one of our largest Islamic conventions in the primaries. And there were a lot of people and people that came, and we had high level celebrities, you know, all kinds of stuff. When Uncle Bernie Sanders came into that room with about 4,000 people who were sitting in that convention center, that roar in that room, I was like, yo, who did Beyonce come? Like, what's happening here? And then they were like, oh no, that's Bernie. That love that our community had for him. Like it, when I figured out it was Bernie, cause I was volunteering outside of the convention room, I literally had tears in my eyes seeing how much love our people had, how much our kids looked up to him. So anyway, we love you, Uncle Bernie. Hopefully you watch the Katie Halper show.
Yes. Gotta come on. Yeah. I got chills. Not to be corny. I got goosebumps, but listen, whatever.
Every time I talk about Uncle Bernie.
Yeah.
Love you.
Yeah. Well, yes. So thank you so much, really. And it's so important to also to all these people who are like, oh, Muslims and Jews, like they hate each other. They can't get along. It's like such an important thing. Oh my God. The photo of him with, is it Ilhan Omar's daughter where he's picking her up? That was like,
that's Uncle Bernie. Listen.
What is wrong with people who hate him? Like, it's just
it's
pathological. Like, even if you don't like his politics, how on earth can you not?
Let me just tell you,
solidarity is a fucking trip. Is really what it is.
I don't cancel anybody. I'm not. You know me. I'm not into cancel culture. You see me. I don't engage in it at all. But if you hate Uncle Bernie Sanders, canceled. Hashtag.
I agree. Yeah, that's a great. That's a great policy. Yeah, that's my line. That's my line in the sand. Yeah. Well, Linda, again, thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.
And come back and let us know when your things are less secret, you know, so we know what to be fighting for.
It's going to be good, Katie. Yeah. You're going to be proud.
Great. Thank you so much.
Good to talk to you.
Bye.
That was great.
She's an amazing speaker.
Really, really. Yeah. A couple of great interviews. That was very, you know, it does
make
me hopeful.
We're not talking about you, by the way, the people who are saying, he's a sellout. I mean, I think it's but we're talking about the people to the right who hate him.
Sorry. Yeah. I mean, I thought this was, both were very good interviews, you know, honestly hearing from Linda, you know, makes me feel a little more hopeful about the incoming Biden administration, even though I've not felt very hopeful about it. You know, whenever I talk to organizers, it like actually does, you know, give me like energy again, you know what I mean? Like, cause like you can look at the reality of it. And so how powerless the left feels right now, especially on the national level or whatever. And, you know, kind of look at that realistically, but when you talk to organizers, you sort of understand, you know, that people are going to be making strides. And even if it's not Biden, you know, people are doing good work out there. People are doing good work out there and getting the people together. You know, I really do think, you know, this election is the result of this election is so wild, and that they, you know, are already like, you know, jumping over themselves to left punch out of this. I think it's going to be a pretty rough couple of years.
I mean, just because of the pandemic, it's going to be no matter what, like even if it was on Bernie. He would do a lot of good stuff that would help ameliorate it. But yeah,
it's going to be a brutal. I mean, you know, the Senate held, you know, the Senate held by Republicans and Joe Biden trying to COVID relief is like over at this point. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
we got once. I can't believe how
I can't even believe it. Like Nancy Pelosi was like, we've got all the quivers, all this kind of arrows in our quiver. They gave up all of their leverage. Like they're not going to give Biden like a win of sending out checks to everybody. I thought for half a second that Trump might do it on his way out just to get goodwill, but he's not going to do that because he's too obsessed with some stupid bullshit, like going to court and all this stupid shit.
Well, I'm going to read some comments and then I want to actually suggest, I have a list of things that I would like to urge Trump to do that I think he could own the libs with it, and we on the left, okay, this is so you can own the libs, Trump. I want you to embarrass the libs. But also, they're good things.
Yeah.
So ready? Okay. So I'll read that, and then we'll get to the comments. Because there are certain things that I think he should be moved to do. God, I get so many emails, by the way, from Trump and Pence and other members of the regime. Okay, so here's...
Yeah, they're all watching.
They're all watching. I mean, I just get them. They have a good email game. They think my name is Al, though. So that's why they lost. If they were more organized, they know my name is Katie. And okay, so here's some things I would like Trump to take on to own the libs, only for those reasons. Pardon Assange.
Mm-hmm.
Because the libs hate him. They consider him a traitor, and they hate him because they think he helped get you the election. So you need mm-hmm. to punish those people because they are anti-Trump, and yeah. that's why they hate him.
It's a good idea.
And they're pro-Hillary. So you want to break the hearts of pro-Hillary, anti-Trump people. So that's why you're going to pardon Assange. Snowden, same thing. Exactly the same thing. I mean, Hillary said he's to come back and face the music. No. Kiriakou. Come on, Kiriakou, John Kiriakou, he needs to get his benefits reinstated because his pension reinstated because he's the only guy to go to jail for the CIA torture stuff. And he didn't even participate in it. So help me make that. Why is that something Trump would like? He doesn't like. Why would he? I mean, he said the CIA has done some bad stuff, right? Isn't that what he said? Or was it the United States has killed some people? I need the angle here. I have a feeling the CIA, you know, Trump, if you had won, I don't think the CIA would have let you stay in power.
Yeah, that could be.
Buttigieg disagrees with me, but we're going to work on that. Then you got to pardon non-violent drug offenders, obviously, because you already took that First Step Act. What was it called? The First Step Act or something?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the First Step Act. He doesn't need to pardon everybody. You know what you should do is just say, get all those violent criminals, all those violent drug addict criminals that are in all the prisons and have them overrun all the sanctuary cities. Let all the prisoners out of every prison and then let the liberals deal. See how much they like that.
Yeah, yeah. Mariella Boatlet.
Pardon actually everybody.
Pardon everyone.
Do a wide pardon of pardon of all crimes ever done.
Yeah, I agree. Then Leonard Peltier, you want to know why you got to free Leonard Peltier in specific, even if you don't on the off chance that you don't jump on the blanket pardon ship that Jack is sailing, of which Jack is at the helm, Leonard Peltier, because the FBI, you don't like the FBI, right? I mean, the FBI, like, they don't like you, Trump. They weren't good on you with Russia stuff. They went after you. I can't hear you, Jack. Did you unplug? Like, you have no audio. Uh-oh. You see, this is what happened. We're speaking truth to power. The NSA, the CIA, and the FBI heard our plans, and they're like, shut it down. We'll try to shut down Katie, but it's easier to shut down Jack for some reason. What happened, guys? Don't hear you. It's not just me, right? Can you guys not hear him? Hold on. Private chat. Let's see. Your audio stopped. I don't know. Weird. Okay. He's going to reload. So I got Leonard Peltier and then anything else? You know, it's funny. I was talking about this. I came up with this idea with a friend the other night. And then look what Rose McGowan, who I got to have on the show. Let me show you what she did. Because we got it. Look, just like Laura Ingraham spoke to Trump in a way to get him basically she obviously wanted him to step down. You gotta, flattery gets you everywhere with this guy. So let's see, Rose McGowan. What do we got? This is a good tweet, let's see. I retweeted this. This is pretty good. You gotta meet him where he's at, you know? It's a very good organizing principle. Okay, Jack is back. Let's see. Can we hear you?
Should be working.
Yeah, now we can hear you. Yeah.
Is that good? Cool.
Yeah. I just want to give a shout out to Rose McGowan because her tweet is like basically along the lines of what I'm thinking of. Do you see that?
Yeah.
It says free Assange, you know they lied at real Donald Trump. And then it's Republicans. This is a great photo. Let's see. Republicans with a bunch of missiles, and then Democrats they're both warplanes, right? And then the Democrats one has Black Lives Matter on it, and then Yes We Can and a rainbow. So it's a pretty good metaphor.
Yeah.
So I like it. She's like appealing to his kind of anti-authority, you know, distrustful conspiracy theorist side. The irony is when liberals hate human rights. What is this guy talking about?
You know.
Anyway, whatever.
What everybody's talking about.
Yeah, we can't go there. But those are my ideas. And then let's just let's see. Let's read some. Let's see. Yeah, just own the libs, like because Biden and Obama kind of pretend to be good on those things and they're not, but they pretend to be for the civil liberties stuff. So you got to come in and be like, I'm the one who pardoned Peltier because the FBI sold me out. They don't have my back, and I'm the one. Oh, they spied. Didn't they spy on him?
On Peltier?
No, on Trump.
Oh, that's what he says. Yeah, that's what he says.
I think maybe
shutter the FBI by executive order.
Yes,
they hate you. Intelligence community.
That's what I'm
doesn't
saying.
Like you. So that's and why you could got to
free Assange and Snowden. Then you shutter those things.
Shutter it all by executive order.
Shutter it down.
We're done.
You heard that? Yeah. Shutter it down. and then let's see what else. We really do have to go over how evil those people are, though. Okay, hold on. Tony Sparks, thank you for the super sticker.
Super sticker, hell yeah.
So generous, right? Let's see. Leslie Lee has been great, by the way. But last night, Trevor Bulio showed me this Bree Newsom tweet that I hadn't seen. And Leslie
my God.
Was, like, so good
on it. The new thing of like working class just is white supremacy whatever.
Yeah.
It's really exhausting and fucked
it's
up.
So exhausting. And also, ironically, totally invisibilizing and racist and all that. So then Brian Frederick writes, Biden is going to get us into another war. Totally. I fully believe in that is possible. Let's see what else we got.
Biden already has signaled toughness on China, and like that will be bipartisan. Like why shouldn't toughness that if you want to look for a way that the Overton window has shifted from Donald Trump being elected,
you pointed
this out. It is like China hatred. It is like we remember in 2016 when Trump was running and he was like China, and everybody was like, that's horrendous. Why would you say that about China? Now here we are 4 years later, and it's totally bipartisan to be like, China is one of our main enemies or whatever.
Yeah,
you know,
beautiful.
And what's happened in the interim time? Like, what changed during that time? We just imposed tariffs on them. You know what I mean? Like, that's really the thing that changed between 2016 and now.
Observer
unless you,
said,
unless you oh, believe sorry. That they created COVID, right. Which I don't personally.
Right. Personally, not so much. Yeah. Observer writes, Trump's too scared to cross the deep state to pardon Assange. Sparky writes, Trump was finally getting rid of CIA Director Gina Haspel. Biden will likely keep her. Could Biden be a case of be careful what you wish for?
Look, I think Biden, everybody, yesterday is the last day anybody should feel happy about a Biden victory. Yeah, you know what I mean?
I'll give like, it until Monday.
It's okay. It's fine to celebrate Trump being out. Yeah, it's fine to celebrate Trump being out. I'm not trying to be a wet blanket about it. I heard all sorts of, you know,
well, I don't know how you get excited about it. But
and fireworks.
Can, yeah,
I understand.
I mean, I understand. Yeah,
I understand being excited to watch Trump lose.
Yeah,
I'm excited to watch Trump lose. It has been fun to watch him lose. He is flailing and looks like a dumbass, you know.
It is fun. Yeah. Can Trump legalize weed by rescheduling it? Sean White asks. That's something else he needs to do. Legalize weed.
Yeah. Move it to schedule zero.
Yeah. You know, Trump thinks outside the box. He thinks about how
legalize all of them by executive order. Like if Trump just really on the last day was like cocaine, it's legal. Cocaine's fully legal.
Wait, they don't have. Okay. Jonathan Tipton Myers writes, they don't hate Bernie. They're afraid like I was to have faith in ourselves and our government to change and support cannabis to free people. Someone said free Mumia Abu-Jamal and Chelsea Manning. Chelsea Manning is free now, right?
I believe so.
Yeah, but give her a blanket immunity. Yeah. So she doesn't
have
to deal with any
no
of this
more
shit.
Getting locked up.
Yeah.
No more getting locked up. Yeah.
Oh, Tony Sparks. Wow. Hey, guys, pizza on me. Tony Sparks sent us $100.
Oh, wow. That's
huge. Tony Sparks. That's huge.
Thank you so much, Tony
Sparks.
And
you know, pizza is my favorite food. Not even kidding.
I had some pizza just the other night. What a special treat
night.
For me.
So
special
good.
Treat for me.
Plain and mushroom are both great.
Wow.
Mixed
I do like a cheese pizza.
It's so
pizza.
Good.
Yeah.
Mixed wire. I like pizza so much. I don't tell anyone. I'm like, is it Bloomberg or is it de Blasio who cuts? I like to eat it with
a knife. I think it might have been Kasich.
No. Oh, maybe him too.
Yeah.
But there was a New Yorker too. I do it because it's, or else it's gone in a second. It's to slow it down. That's how much I like pizza. Let's see. Mixed Wire Productions, Owning Us Libs. I'm trying to highlight them, but I can't. So thank you, Mixed Wire Productions. Tony Sparks. Okay. Thank you so much. Johnson Tipton Myers, 2022 starts now. Indeed. How much was it the world socialism versus word socialism versus FDR? Is that what I think that was at 743? So sorry, I'm just getting to it, but I think that's a reference to, maybe the Bernie Sanders using that word. Jonathan Tipton Myers also writes, Chappelle gave the acceptance speech I needed. Is he that addicted? Like, has anyone else been on that show and smoked a cigarette?
That's Chappelle's new thing, is he just smokes cigarettes whenever he wants to. And I kind of like it. And you are allowed to smoke as part of a performance. That is like the law, actually, is like you're not allowed to smoke indoors, like if you're like attending a bar, but you can smoke in a performance. So you can like smoke on stage at comedy shows and stuff like that. And that doesn't count as the like no smoking indoors rule or whatever.
How is that possible? That's
weird. I think
because
it's performance. I don't know. Like, I think you're just allowed to smoke. I don't know.
That's very weird. There's something suspicious about that, in my opinion. Someone just texted me this and said, we are so fucked. if you're watching this, thanks for sending it. And I'm going to talk to you very soon, by the way. I owe you a phone call and a strategy session. Mitt Romney has been asked to lead Health and Human Services in Biden administration.
Yeah.
Levi Sanders tweeted that out.
Oh my God. Wow.
Wait. Is it fake news? It's BuffaloChronicle.com.
Okay. So it might just be one of these things where it's like floating or whatever, where it's a float. Like, I saw one yesterday that was like, you know, Dick Cheney's going to advise or whatever. And that one, I think, was not based on anything real. It is like, you know, a lot of really awful Republicans are going to be advisors and be part of the Biden, you know, administration. It doesn't need to be.
We don't have
to come up with fake ones. You know what I mean?
It is satire, by the way.
Okay.
It's a parody site that, you know, I don't care about the fake news stuff as much as I do. You need a satire warning. It just saves that's the censorship I support. Let's see. Anyway, so whatever, we have our hands full.
You know, it's a victory that's not any kind of real victory. I think it's like, you know, the liberals, their entire argument of this election, you know, has been undercut by how narrow the win was and by how hairy the entire thing got. But we're still going to get blamed for that. The left is going to be blamed for that. And the Biden administration is going to be what the Biden administration was always going to be, like pretty much a Republican administration, like an 04, you know, George W. Bush administration. You know what I mean? Like,
I know.
The establishment. And so, you know, what happens next is, like, in my opinion, personally, I think the presidency for the left is lost until at least 2030. And I think the left, like I was saying with Linda, we just need more players. We need like a deeper bench. Like, we have AOC, we have the squad, but we need hundreds of people. You know what I mean? Like, because, you know, we need people to kind of be there and slot into these positions so that we can't get fucked over by all these old people. And like I'm saying before, we need to smother every neoliberal up and comer in the cradle. Like, we need them all to be so toxic they cannot go anywhere. I swear to God.
Yeah,
if
I agree.
I'm like looking at this election and I'm like, what the left is actually good at is not winning presidential elections. We're pretty good at these insurgent candidacies, and we're also good as a wide left altogether, like destroying politicians. Like, we are actually really good at tanking other campaigns. So we really need to stay very vigilant at that and tank the campaigns of every single challenger. Like, we really need to build our backbench, but then also like kill theirs.
Right.
We need to make sure that they can, like a Pete Buttigieg, that is the most dangerous thing. Young neoliberals, we need to be like unflinching. We actually need to destroy them. You know what I mean? Like
build back bench better.
And I even see people like,
build back bench better. That's absolutely
correct. Build back bench better.
Our slogan, yeah.
You know, I see people in the chat even saying like AOC is not left enough. And it's like, whether or not you agree with that or disagree with that, I don't even want to litigate that. We just need more people than right. AOC.
Yeah.
Like that, the core of even that argument, even saying AOC is not left enough.
Right.
I would be like, sure, I agree. We need more people that are further left than
right.
AOC.
Yeah.
We need a whole bunch of people in there. You know what I mean? If AOC was like the most centrist of like the left flank, I would be like, holy fuck, we're in a good spot.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? That's like, we're in a very good spot.
Yeah.
But those are like the two planks. I'm like the left. I think what we can do is keep doing organizing, keep this local energy going, because I think we're good at it. But then we're really, really good at destroying people's political careers. When they don't
have someone to slide in.
Yeah, we need to have someone to like go against. But we also really need to like, you know, it was interesting. Linda said that in her district, you know, there was a shitty Democrat that didn't win. And now there's a shitty Republican in who's going to be doing annoying stuff or whatever. We can't do this again. We can't concede. We can't roll over and like give the endorsement to Biden because of how unique a threat Trump is. I actually don't even disagree with everyone who ended up ultimately having to do that. I do bristle, and I was posting a little bit about this today, at all the people who so immediately went to endorsing Biden. You know what I mean? Like, I do think that there were folks on the left who like really squandered out, not even Bernie or politicians, because you know, there's unseen pressures with them and stuff like that, but even people in independent media like really like rolled over too quickly, and I think that makes us look weak. You know what I mean? Like the left can't be so weak.
I agree.
We are weak as shit right now, and like, you know, we need to like show a better face at this stuff. And if that actually means, you know, frankly, like a shitty centrist Democrat getting beaten at some local level by a Republican, we actually have to take that. You know what I mean? Because we can't keep having the knife at our throat for centrists or nothing. Like, you know what I mean? Like they have to take L's, and we have to say, we're not like going to do this again. We're not giving you the vote, and we're not giving you the energy again, because it's not Trump again, you know?
Right.
So anyway, that's kind of stuff. That's what I've been thinking about.
after the
Biden win.
People are fighting about getting censored here or criticizing me. I agree. Warren's a literal snake. Agree.
I do too. And frankly, you know, I think Warren, you know, Warren's been pushing so hard for like a cabinet position, and I'm like, man, this person needs primaried so bad. I'm not even fucking around.
And you know what? That's my favorite thing about Biden so far, is that he hasn't named her and hasn't made any overtures to her. And that is nice.
Listen,
that's harm reduction.
Look, that's like Bernie's not going to get one either. And I also think it would be a bad idea for Bernie to take.
I don't want to. Bernie, if you're listening, I should
get fired. Because he can get fired from that position. And that's what happened to Corbyn.
Yes. Listen to Jack on this, and take stock in Corbyn's whatever you want to call it.
Offices. Do not take a job where Joe Biden can fire you. Ever.
Yeah, do not. Yeah.
I know also, you think
don't
he's
leave
your
the Senate. Don't leave the Senate.
Don't leave the Senate. There is no actual left. I agree with Kate. And this is kind of what I'm talking about, is I'm like, this is why it needs to happen locally. And while it's happening locally, we need to stop any rising stars, because like rising stars are going to be the issue. Like
the bad rising stars.
Yeah. But, you know, the only people in the Democrat Party who like have, you know, built in Q rating are all old as fuck. They're all super old.
Wait, what's Q rating? Sorry.
It's just like, it's what they call, you know, I shouldn't be saying it now because of QAnon or whatever.
That's what I thought it meant.
But it just is it's a phrase that means like, you know, like approval rating pretty much, but
okay,
for celebrities. It's like, if you have a high Q rating, people like you and have a positive thought about you or whatever. I'm like, you know, the Democrats don't really have anybody outside of like Biden. They have like Pelosi. They have all these people that like have been around for years and that people know, but like when it comes to like Pete, people like who's young, who are the young Democrats that we know about? Like Beto's already back, like teaching at college. You know what I mean? Like Pete Buttigieg is just like writing a book or something. Like they don't have young people. Like we have the young people on the left.
I agree. We've got people, as AOC says. Jack Flash writes, and how do we get more than 7 out of 450 federal representatives, non-voters, independents, which requires a third party, and we need to start now. Observer writes, Trump's lasting success, win or lose, was shifting the whole political spectrum deliriously far right. Yeah.
I mean, I would also say that Trumpism is not dead in any way. Trumpism, you know, actually got a really big election victory this time. Got 71 million votes. So the sort of the whole conceit of the Biden campaign was they were going to kick his ass so bad that Trumpism was going to like limp out of here as the pathetic thing that it is. And that has not happened. Trumpism is out, but is out of the White House, but it's like stronger than ever. And this man is going to go to fucking Mar-a-Lago to basically be the messiah figure of a political religion.
Right.
So like this guy's still around. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And he also it's not, you know, the fact that the media, not to sound like a Trumpian, but I mean, I've made this point before, the media was ridiculous about him. Like the Russiagate stuff was ridiculous. And that gives Trump supporters a lot of ammo in thinking that, oh yeah, he really did win. And it's just the media. It's this, that, the
and
other.
Also, this man might run again in 2024. Yeah. Like, you know, I really think that, you know, this guy is a weird, like, listen, Trump is not going anywhere. Trump is, I think, even still going to probably be covered by cable news. Like, I bet they'll send a remote team down to Mar-a-Lago to catch like little comments from Trump about what Biden's doing and shit like that. And then Trump's going to be back on the campaign trail like in 2022 with all these Republicans. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, it's so funny. Everybody feels like, oh, good, Trump is gone. I'm like, Trump is not gone.
Right.
This man's father lived to 95.
I know. It's always like only the good die young. What was it? It's like George H. Bush, Rockefeller, Kissinger's still alive. Pinochet. Yeah. It's always. Yeah.
It's always the worst.
Always the worst. Well, this was great. And guys, come up with other ideas that we can get Trump to do. Let's troll Trump to the left. Now I'm going to get all these people like, oh, you like Trump. You think Trump's leftist, blah, blah, blah. Whatever. Everyone knows it's a lie. He happens to be very funny unintentionally, but that's neither here nor there. But
you can find someone funny while thinking that the politics are very bad. Lame. He is funny as shit. Are you kidding me?
It was a lame excuse. What he said about Ilhan Omar, it was like, oh my God, he's so ridiculous. Anyway. Yeah. Interesting. Someone's Cloud Skies now says Bernie fractured the coalition by endorsing. I think maybe endorsing a little too early. I mean, I'm going to be honest. You guys know that I love Bernie. I felt very comfortable talking with Linda about it. And I think that Linda also has her criticisms. And like, I am angry at Bernie for certain things, but I'm still, and I think it, you know, the irony is this is kind of meta is that like, just like, I was upset that Bernie let his personality, you know, his affection for Biden get in the way. I can't let my affection for Bernie get in the way, except I'm not a sitting senator or at with any political power. So it's fine. But I think we can push and you know what, though? I'm going to say this. I don't, people in the chat or wherever, obviously it's up to you what to do. But like, I'm not going to say he's like a corporate tool sell. Like he disappointed me. He is disappointing in many ways. I disagree with him on things, but like, I just don't see he's such a relatively, like, for a politician, he's so uniquely not evil.
Listen, in my opinion, I maybe am a little disappointed too that Bernie dropped out when he did and that he endorsed when he did.
He should
a lot of that shit has to come with, like, goes with like DC bullshit and stuff like that. I am more annoyed with like independent media that endorsed Biden so early.
Like who are you talking about?
Well, I mean, even like you know, like Nathan J. Robinson and like the Current Affairs folks or whatever were really early on making this harm reduction argument for Biden. And I'm like, you don't have to make that argument until like October.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like we just rolled over
and
capitulated so quickly. Like the very second that like he won, we capitulated and that's why we didn't exact any demands. You know what I mean? Like we just immediately were like, you know, we believe in electoralism so much, let's just like give up completely. I'm like, So I'm a, like, Bernie is an elected official. You know what I mean? And Bernie is a senator and he's working in D.C. and he maybe has in his mind that he might be able to accomplish some things that he wants to get done that will help people. And maybe he feels that, like, endorsing Biden will get him some capital to be able to do that.
Yeah,
that's all fine. That's D.C. bullshit. Independent media and all these kind of people, I'm like, you didn't need to, and you're not going to get anything for it. You know what I mean? You just lot of these people just thought them that their platform was so important and got on an ego trip about all their listeners and how important they were to the election. And I'm like, you mistook what your duty is here. Right. Your duty is to, like, hold the politicians accountable, not to fucking lecture your listeners every day.
And chide them about
how bad Trump is. Right. Everybody knows it's not very interesting analysis to say that Biden is better than Trump marginally. You know what I mean?
Right.
We could have got to that analysis very easily in October. We didn't need to, like, have 8 months of leftists beating the drum for Biden. And then the day after he's elected being like, what? He's selecting bad people.
Right.
You know, that should piss me off.
I agree. Well, actually this is interesting. Garden Gnome writes, in the end, it doesn't matter what Bernie's intent was. The outcome is what matters. The outcome is he produced are definitely mixed bag. I think that's true. But I do think if we want to, like, honestly, just from an intra-left strategic perspective, I think that there's some people who will dismiss you if you kind of out of the bag say Bernie is, like, writ large a neoliberal shill sellout. So I actually think, like, if we want to make certain cases, but who cares? I mean, I don't know, to the extent that any of us have any power. I mean, I don't know. I don't think that, like, Linda Sarsour shilled for.
I think that's a very different. I'm not talking.
Yeah,
about
I know. I know. I'm sorry. I'm reading the comments. I'm reading the comments.
We're talking about, like, organizers who are going out there and organizing people and making a harm reduction argument and stuff like that. That's not at all what I'm talking about. I just wanted to clarify, too. I'm talking about, like, media people who think that, like, actually, to be honest with you, like, media people, like, in organizers are as important as media people think they are. You know what I mean? Like, these media people think, like, oh, with my stream, I'm swinging the election.
Right.
No, organizers are out there doing that work. You're just, like, trying to, like, you know, what you're trying to do is, like, you know, advocate for policy and, like, you know, get people to, like, know what are the things that should happen and shit like that, you know.
Hold on, Jack, can I give you person the stream for like 2 minutes? I gotta shut off my thing for a second. Let's see, what do we want to respond to?
Well, look, there's a lot people all the time talk about, you know, third party or new party versus the Democrats or whatever, and I really don't know. I you know, I'm really a big proponent for destroying the Democratic Party. And so I am really not sure whether the shorter path to that, you know, is a third party, you know, or continuing the ongoing plan of, like, chipping away at the inside. I don't believe in electoralism, certainly on the national level, but I actually do think, like, you know, with these city councils and Congress and stuff like that, that, you know, we can make some progress there. You know, I don't know. yeah, I kind of agree. I just am like, you know, people.
Wait, what do you kind of agree with? You have to say.
I was agreeing with Cloudy Skies Now. It was like progressive YouTubers who live in blue states were shilling for Biden. It was so gross. Listen, I think we need to destroy the party, whether it's a third party or whether it's a, you know, just, you know, systematically getting people in, like doing like what Scientology does or something like that. I agree with Robert Lewis. Why not both? Let's just try both. Like, you know, let's give a big, I would honestly, you know, I'm a supporter of the People's Party, the Progressive People's Party. And I'm also a supporter of, like, trying to unseat and get rid of every shitty fucking corporate Democrat. And I think that we need to be, like, absolutely, you know, like, you know, with no prejudice. We need to destroy every corporate Democrat, you know, kind of regardless of the consequence, because, you know. We're done. Oh my God. Jack, you're right, but you laugh like Kamala, elbow cough. I mean, it's true. I definitely do the thing where I kind of laugh at my own stuff and, you know, do it to punctuate sentences and stuff like that. It's just the way it's going to be. It's just the way that I've learned to speak. You know, I say like a lot. I nervously laugh. It's the way it is.
You say, you know,
you know. I say, you know,
I say, a lot, and I've been podcasting for a while.
I simply speak in the way I speak, you know.
No, he's unaffected.
I did it again.
He's unaffected.
It is going to be the way it's going to be, unfortunately. I have to run pretty soon, okay, Katie, yeah. But it is always a pleasure. I know. Yes. I got to have some dinner too.
But you're healthier than I am because it's 9:20. It's way too late to eat.
You know, I sleep by 9 every night.
Yeah, you're right. Much healthier. You have much better sleep hygiene as well.
You know, but the East Coasters are always up a little later because you guys, you know, you get sports events ending at fucking midnight.
Oh, yeah,
you
know,
all the elections end at like 2.
My life, yeah. I say right a lot. I know. I say yeah and right because as a host, I feel like I have to affirm what people are saying, but I've heard your, your complaints and I will try to not do it as much.
I will say that I try not to laugh like, you know, about like human tragedy and stuff like Kamala does. Like Kamala will laugh, like they'll say like, you know, 250,000 people are dead from COVID and she'll be like,
yeah. It was a debate. Remember that? It was a debate. Build independent left culture institutions first. Reject Mamad in South Dakota. A young labor leader wants to rebuild a cultural solidarity. Okay.
Look, that's the other thing is actually, you know, I do think, you know, independent media is important. And that's why I am pissed off at like people that are in, you know, independent media making these endorsements early and everything like that. Because, you know, in addition to, you know, doing all this, trying to get people in Congress and at the local level and everything like that, we do need to build our left media ecosystem. Yeah. And that's something that I actually, you know, I actually am very heartened by, is that I think we have done a pretty good job of building a left media ecosystem, and we need more of it, and we need it to get more popular. But we also need people to be very conscious about what that means and what we're advocating for and what the long-term planning is. You know what I mean? Like, you don't just anyway.
I do know what you mean. I think, yeah, look, we are, what we provide people is an outlet. We need Lisa Mojica is telling you she loves your laugh.
Oh, well, thank you, Lisa.
Yeah. We need to have people have fun, and we need to be a, you know, a refuge. Mm-hmm. Also, I don't think someone's saying something not very nice about Nick Brana. Not to call you out. I mean, I don't think he comes off as fake. I think he's very sweet. I think actually, honestly, you know, I think he has a constant, kind of like Jack laughs, like, but Jack's laugh isn't fake the way Kamala's is. Like, Kamala is trying to elicit, she's trying to create the illusion of warmth and humanity. But Nick Brana, I think, is actually just incredibly smiley. Like, I think he's just a very smiley guy. But I think Ryan Knight is the other guy at People's Party, so I'll look into that. But that is not because I'm throwing Nick under the bus at all. I think Nick is very thoughtful, a very thoughtful man who's Chilean, by the way, which is interesting because I asked him about that the other day. I really got to release more clips, put them out on the social medias and all that jazz. Oh, Jack, weren't you saying the other day, and then I'll let you go. Weren't you saying the other day something, or someone saying that we could like stream Amazon Prime movies on Twitch?
Yeah. So I mean, it's like annoying and people have to have Twitch or Amazon for it or whatever. However, a lot of times people will set up like a little side stream for anyone who doesn't have Amazon Prime. And as a streamer, you have nothing to do with that, obviously.
Okay, yeah.
But on Twitch, if people have Amazon Prime, you can like watch whatever movies are on Amazon Prime as a little like watch party or whatever. So
I have a Twitch account, which you helped me with.
Yeah,
a lot of guidance. Can I use StreamYard for Twitch?
Yeah, I think so. I'm pretty sure.
I think I'm gonna have to do this because I mean, wouldn't that be fun? I feel so stifled that I'm not allowed to like
watch videos and stuff.
So yeah. What's a good movie? You guys, let's vote. What movie do you want me to watch?
You could probably watch. I mean, to finally watch Fahrenheit 11/9 after getting canceled for it.
Oh yeah. Although I mean, that's a good movie.
It's kind of old now at this point. It's maybe not that necessary.
I mean, what I should do is, you know what I could do with that is is it on Prime Video, Amazon Prime? What I could do is try to do a fundraiser or something for with Michael Moore doing like a director's cut commentary on it.
Mm-hmm. And by the way, people in chat are saying
organization, not for me. Yeah.
I was people in chat were saying, you know, you get a Prime subscription if you're you have to have an Amazon Prime subscription to watch the stream. You don't, because they also have Twitch Prime, which is a whole separate thing. And you're subscribing to channels. You need to have an Amazon Prime subscription to be able to watch the little stream movies or whatever.
Got it.
But like I said, usually there's a resourceful person in chat who sets up a side stream for anyone who doesn't.
Right.
It would be a great way. I think you should do them.
Yeah. What should we watch?
I don't know what's on there that's even good to watch. Amazon Prime Video. What do they have?
I'm closing the screen again. I'm not gonna lie. I'm like, I'm absolutely starving, so I'm taking a bite of a veggie burger, but I don't want to do that on screen. So one second, let me go off.
Wow. I'm jealous. I want some veggie burger now. Now I want some veggie burger. What could you watch on? I'm looking on it now. They have The Boys, obviously. That's just The Boys. I don't know. I don't know what good. I don't know if they have any good like documentaries or anything like that. labornotes.org/films. Okay. Up and About. Man, I haven't even seen these movies. Real Women, Breaking Away, Made in Manhattan, I guess. I don't know. Expanse, I was thinking about watching with Leslie on there. They have the full, I've never watched The Expanse. Could be a good one to watch. Oh yeah, Repo Man rocks. Repo Man is a really good movie.
Made in Manhattan is really good. I loved it.
Made in Manhattan. Yeah, this is, I think watch parties are going to kind of be a fun, are going to be a good thing to do.
Let's do it. I want to do one. So do I add it to my YouTube streams? Yeah, right.
Yeah, I think you could. Yeah, you could just tell people to go over to the Twitch, for once a week, and you watch a movie or something.
That'll be really fun. I'm not gonna lie. What should we watch? All right, sorry, I kept asking that. Can we watch? What I really want is the ability to watch MSNBC.
Unfortunately, dream, right? Unfortunately, just I've tried to do it a couple times with different things. You get pulled. You just get pulled. They don't do it.
Is there anything like we could watch like Aaron Sorkin?
Yeah, like, you could watch like West Wing episodes or something.
This is why. Oh, is that on there, Amazon Prime? Oh,
I don't know. Let me look. That'd be pretty brutal.
Like, okay, there's Homecoming. That's a great movie. But like, I also kind of want to watch some like really fun stuff. Katie is missing a revenue source. People will pay to see you eat centrally, usually Japanese food or Japanese people.
I mean, you would definitely make if you wanted to do that kind of stream, you could definitely you could do it.
See, that's why I'm not eating on cam, because someone wrote eat on cam !!
Let's see here. Is it on here, West Wing?
I don't know why more people don't do things just with a paper bag over their head. Or is I want to thank you so much, Tony Sparks, not just for donating, but saying it's for pizza, because it's like you read my mind. I've been thinking, I had pizza last night and I've been thinking all day today. I'm like, it's really weird how much I like pizza. It's like, it's scary. Well,
it's one of the best of all meals.
I mean, really.
You could watch Borat 2. Borat 2 is actually a good fit there.
But I talk. I mean, if you're coming into this, you're committing. Like, this is like something that I'm going to generalize.
Yeah. Big time.
But non-WASPs, I'll just say, I think they're that Black viewers of movies, not a monolith, I'm generalizing, and Jewish viewers of movies like to interact with the screen.
This is what I've heard.
Non-Jewish or Black viewers.
I think this is a more, to be honest with you, I've heard this so many times, and in my opinion, I think this is more a New York thing than because I've been to theaters all over the place with many different people. In L.A. just don't talk in theaters that much. People in L.A. we're from the Mecca of movie making. So there's a little more respect for the film. A little more respect for the film nerd.
A human says, I want to watch you eat. And I'll click on that because it's a super chat, but I won't do it. Pizza spot. Oh, man. Yeah. What's a senpai?
Senpai?
Yeah, what's that? What's a senpai?
It's a term of respect in Japanese.
Somewhere, oh my God, Katie, you eating on one side and Joshua Khan drunk on the other screen.
Talking about cut penises.
Yeah, I gotta say, yeah, that was, we got real, he was really, I mean, yeah, let me just send this. This is a good suggestion. Yeah, I want to see a horror movie. Mate, you and Leslie can like, we can go on each other's stream. So we,
yeah, we can do that. I think we're going to start doing more streams with Struggle Session. I'm pretty sure we have a Saturday night stream coming up that we're going to announce pretty soon.
Oh, what is
that? I think it's going to be, I can't announce it just yet, but I think we're going to be with some block of leftist programming. And I think we're going to do a Saturday evening show or something.
Like regularly?
I think every week is the idea.
Wow. Oh, is this something yeah. you guys have?
Something that Leslie emailed me that we're supposed to do.
Great. All right. Sorry. My screams are so disproportionate to the content of what's happening. Like, it sounds like someone's going to die, but it's just almost
right. Right. Up. Just, yeah. Knock something over a little bit.
Yeah.
A little garden burger.
Yeah. Really good. 50 Shades of Orange. What is that? That was the greatest podcast.
Yeah, watch Joker if you haven't seen it yet. Joker's like, if it's on there, let me look. It might be on,
guys. Hold on, I gotta take another. Here, I'll show it to you. You won't see me eating it, but look.
Oh no, you have to buy it.
This will encourage people to donate into the chat.
Wow.
Hold on 1 second. What do you have to buy? What did we just say? I already forgot.
You have to buy Joker, so you can't watch it on stream. Well. Folks, we're rolling on down to the end of the stream here, I suppose. I'm going to have some dinner pretty soon. I'll be going to make myself a little bit of dinner. Now, as for what I'm going to have, I just don't know. Maybe I'll heat up some of the chicken I had for lunch. Or maybe I'll make something totally different and eat that. I'll find out soon after the stream. Anyway, Joker sucked. I don't agree. I don't agree with Joker sucked, but it's like everybody can have their own opinions and stuff like that. I'm not going to I think Joker's like a 6 or 7 out of 10, to be honest with you. It's not like the movie that I'm like going to rep beyond anything else, but also it didn't like make anybody into mass shooters and people have some sort of weird people that like blue check marks are weird and uptight about it for some reason, which I find fun. Actually, I do find it fun that blue check marks for some reason, like get freaked out about the movie. But I mean like whatever, it's like, you know, it's like a whatever movie.
What about this? Katie Halper, you can use Discord to watch Joker?
That's true. You can go on Discord. You can't really stream stuff out on Discord, but if you had a Discord channel, you could watch whatever movies you want with your audience.
I just can't stream it.
You could be in a big shared room and watch it together, but you wouldn't be streaming it out to YouTube or anything like that.
To Twitch.
I am in LA, Jonathan Tipton Myers. Thoughts on homelessness in LA? It's really terrible. But I am heartened by, you know, the victory of Nithya Raman and, you know, the work being done by, groups like, Ground Game LA, you know, this is kind of exactly the thing I'm talking about is like, you know, Ground Game LA ran a lot of races this year. You know, Nithya Raman is like a city planner, who's worked very closely with the homeless community, and Ground Game LA is very specifically works with the unhoused community and stuff like that. You know, we need better leadership. Unseating the neoliberal city council members, and you know, hopefully we'll get somebody better in after Garcetti. You know, it's really fucking inhumane. And you see more people in the streets every day, and you know, the cops will come out and bulldoze people's tents and stuff like that. And you know, it's really horrendous. And you know, it's. You can't go around LA without seeing what a failure sort of neoliberal governance is. And so I'm glad that there are actual groups out here of organizers who are doing the work to make things change.
That sounds good. Oh, maybe we'll get some discovery. Wait, maybe Michelle Forbes can come on and talk to us a bit.
Oh, yeah.
What is it? Yeah. New generation, next generation. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Michelle Forbes rocks. Michelle Forbes is really the best. She's the best. Yeah.
But I want to watch some corny stuff that's funny to laugh at. I mean, we can watch real good cinema.
You know, Katie, I bet you would really like, and maybe you just skip season one. You would really like season two of The Boys, I think.
Okay.
Season two of The Boys is really good of the moment television that I think it's a superhero show, but it really makes fun of the whole superhero thing. And it really gets modern fascism in America more than any other show that I think I've like watched recently. And it doesn't shy away from it. It's like explicit. This is about American, you know, oh shit. I'm actually looking at a comment from Jonathan Tipton Myers about the good pizza to get.
I know. I was
La
just
Monica's I've had before. Vito's I got to try out. Oh, Starship Troopers rocks. You should watch that.
Oh, I want to watch Showgirls because I told you I had a professor at Wesleyan who explained how it was feminist. I was very skeptical, and then he was right.
I know Showgirls, you know, that's a you know, it's a bit, it's such a good, I mean, honestly, it does actually rock so much. It's Paul Verhoeven. Paul Verhoeven is like one of the greatest, like, you know, sort of anti-fascist directors that we have, to be honest with you.
But it's cool because you don't know, like, it doesn't, unless you know his politics, you're just being.
But did you know that he grew up? This is why I think Starship Troopers is so good, is that he didn't grow up a lot under it, but he was a young boy under Nazi occupation. And so he saw what like culture was like under actual fascism.
In Holland?
I think maybe in Poland or something like that. But yes, and he was very young. So it wasn't like he was somebody who was like grown up. He was just a little kid, but he like did see. And I think that like he gets the kind of like, you know, just the sort of ugly meanness and, you know, I don't know. It's great.
Huh. RoboCop is anti-fascist. Yeah. But you guys are. Okay. We'll watch some good.
Oh, movies. RoboCop is anti-fascist as a motherfucker. Yeah. Right. Anti-corporate, anti-fascist. Watch Verhoeven movies for real.
But
even his early porno movies are not quite as political, but they're funny.
You mean porno movies. So maybe it's not Steel Magnolias is hilarious. Maybe it's not a critique than Showgirls.
Well, no, he definitely likes sex and stuff like that, and he likes to put, you know, horny stuff in movies or whatever, right. But I do think Showgirls is a critique, and it's a comedy, too. If you watch Showgirls is a comedy.
Yeah, that I would like to watch. Oh, we'll get flagged for nudity, though, it's saying. Well, what if we... No, I didn't go to Wellesley. I went to Wesleyan.
No, I think you can show Showgirls on Twitch as long as you're doing the watch party thing. It won't be broadcasting on your screen. It, like, makes another screen for the movie. So it's like you won't get in trouble for anything that's in the movie.
Got it. But just so you guys know, Is Amazon Prime the same as Amazon Prime Video?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, phew. But just so you know, I want to watch stuff that, like, we will laugh at, like... Not intentionally, but we can also watch good quality stuff. But I'm just saying,
Sense? Yeah, you got to find your Sorkin stuff on there. You got to find your lib documentaries on there and stuff. Exactly. So, we're watching on Jack AM. We watch stuff 1 minute at a time. So people can buy 1 minute of a movie or whatever that we're doing. And so this is just something I run on my own. It's like we have it all queued up here on here. So we're currently, I believe, over 250 minutes into the newsroom. It's so bad. It's so misogynist. It's so neoliberal. It's truly the worst. And then we're also watching Running with Beto, the Crooked Media documentary about Beto O'Rourke's failed Senate run.
Right.
Actually, there was a great moment in Running with Beto in the first 15 minutes where it's this like young Hispanic woman door knocking, and she's like, I used to be a Republican, and then she tells the other woman that what made her not be a Republican anymore was Bernie. So right here in the middle of this Beto documentary, she's like, yeah, that all changed when Bernie came along. And here she is like a Democratic volunteer. I'm like, well, can you people not see this then? Do you not understand the documentary that you're making?
Right. Again, because they're paid not to, they don't want it. It's not about ignorance, you know?
Yeah.
Rambo, that would be fun. Esther House, someone wrote Esther House. Esterhaus wrote Showgirls and Crazy Verhoeven turned into a candy.
Oh, Joe Esterhaus is such. I mean, Joe Esterhaus. Yes, it's he perfect.
What's his name, right? What's it called?
Joe Esterhaus is like. He's like. Yeah, he's like. Yeah, he kind of had his very. Yeah, he did Basic Instinct. He had this like very sort of scummy, pervy '90s movie, you know, run or whatever. But Showgirls is so perfect because it's an Esterhaus script, which is like, so it's all fully like meant all the like all the sort of, you know, over the top pro capitalist stuff. But then Verhoeven takes it and makes it into a comedy. It's really right. special. It's such a good movie.
They work together.
I think that they, I, well, it's the same as Starship Troopers. Starship Troopers as a book is basically a pro-fascist book. It's like, you know, it's a book that is like about this, you know, a humanity fighting against aliens and all the things they had to do. And Verhoeven was asked to make the movie and he read the book and he was like, oh, I think this book is kind of fash. And so he made it into a big satire, you know, about how do we know that the aliens are truly bad and, you know, really isn't fascism the worst thing. Verhoeven does a lot of taking like work and kind of like recontextualizing it.
Got it. Ooh, it looks like maybe Downton's Abbey. I was about to call Downton's Abbey Dawson's Creek. I saw Peggy.
Dawson's Abbey?
Yeah. Yeah, we'll find some good stuff. I feel like I'm not making my point well because people keep saying really good things that but you know, I am open to that, but I'm still looking for the
you want to hate watch. What you want to do is hate watch.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're trying to do a hate watch.
I'm trying to do a hate watch. Not a hate group. Not a hate crime, just a hate watch. Jack Ryan, maybe? I feel like I won't know.
Oh, that would be brutal. The like right? pro see. I mean, watch the second season of Jack Ryan about like Bolivia. That okay. is pretty. That would be pretty funny. I haven't watched it, but just watching the trailers of it, you know, especially knowing how that coup didn't work right. out.
Homecoming. I really like the podcast, by the way, the Homecoming podcast. But I didn't see the show.
I don't know it.
It's with Catherine Keener. Hmm. Ted Bundy falling for a killer. That'll be a laugh and a half. I'm just kidding. Oh, Picnic at Hanging Rock. Also not a laughing matter. But all the I'm just Googled things that are on. Ooh, Lorena about Lorena Bobbitt. Just saying.
Oh, that could be fun. That could be fun. That could yeah. be fun.
Yeah. Betas. What's Betas? It's not about Betos.
Oh, that's supposed to be a good show. People, I think it's about like a Silicon Valley type show.
Oh, I heard this show is good. Comrade Detective. Have you seen that?
Oh, I heard about that show being good too. I haven't watched it, but I've heard that's like a really weird and interesting show.
Yeah, we should watch that. I really want to bring Borgen. Can someone look at it? I don't want to know. I'm going to be, is Borgen on?
I don't know.
It's on Netflix, so it can't be, right?
I mean, it could be. These licenses sometimes are on multiple places unless it's an exclusive.
Right. Well, it's Danish, so, you know, I've been talking about the show a lot, and I'll stop soon, but New Yorker Presents, that kind of looks great. What else? Dr. Thorne, Upload, I Love Dick.
Who knows? I have no idea. I don't know any of these shows. They're Vanity Fair.
Yeah, The Marvelous Mrs. Maisel. My parents sure. like that.
Yeah, I know. Everybody likes that show.
The Boys. I got to watch that because everyone loves that.
It's great.
Expanse. Didn't you just say The Expanse?
I've heard The Expanse is very good. I read a little bit of some of the books. It's a very interesting world.
The Tick. Interesting. Sneaky Pete. Is that about Pete Buttigieg?
No, it predates him, I think.
It's Blago, right? Is it about Blago Blagojevich? Who is it about?
Oh, I think it oh. might. Oh, it's a fiction. No, it's just about a guy that's like a scam artist, I think.
Got it. I heard Bosch is Bosch, whichever.
People like Bosch. People like Bosch. I haven't watched it.
Okay. I really like Fleabag. Is that bad? Does that make me like a neo?
People like, my wife likes Fleabag. I think that we have to be okay. Listen, Struggle Session like is it. All about being okay. Politics right. can't be in every right. single fucking thing. You know what I mean? So it's like, yeah, maybe it's some lib shit, but we all have to like TV shows.
Ooh, The Handmaid's Tale. That could be fun.
That'd be a pretty brutal watch.
Desperate Housewives, The Handmaid's Tale, Halt and Catch Fire, The Americans. I could not get into The Americans. I'm looking at another
list. It's too stupid, awesome. To be honest with you.
It's too stupid, right? I just think it's so stupid.
It's too stupid. It's like too much week to week. They're getting too many like instructions from Russia. It's like truly dumb.
And they're bad actors, I think, and it's bad writing. I'm just going to say it. Mr. Robot. Yeah, Homecoming. It was on that list, too. Ripper Street, The Night Manager. Anyway, we'll figure it out. Maybe you and Leslie can make me enjoy sci-fi.
You know, there's some good stuff out there. There's some good stuff out there.
Oh, you know what?
You would probably like Star Trek: The Next Generation. Star Trek is very socialist. You know, Star Trek takes place in, you know, automated space communism, pretty much.
Okay, got it. Well, I was going to say you really need to watch The Killing.
Watch The Killing. The Killing's on the docket. You've asked this before, and I will eventually do it. I've watched some of the first season.
Is it on Amazon Prime?
I don't know. I don't know.
Yeah. All right. Well, you guys, I will see you all Wednesday.
It looks like it is.
The Killing is on Twitch.
Season one. It looks like season one is included, unless I'm mistaken here.
We're going to have to watch it with Michelle Forbes.
That'd be great.
She'll give one episode, probably. Maybe she'll do one. Yeah, maybe she doesn't want to watch.
Oh, it might be. It might be because I have IMDb. Actually, it says comes with your IMDb subscription. Damn. So, well, maybe not.
Yeah, but we could still invite people. You'll have to. It's still good that I have YouTube, right? Because I don't think it's good to. I don't want him to have like Linda Sarsour on Twitch. Nothing wrong with Twitch, but it has more gravitas. I think.
Maybe. I think YouTube is slightly better for some of these interviews. Yeah.
Slightly better for some. Yeah. All right. Well, Wednesday I'll be here with Jane McAlevey and Adolph Reed.
Oh, wow. That's great.
All right. I saw Sling Blade. It's pretty good. I don't know if I call Sling Blade fun. Pretty dark, but I did like it. And the great thing about Sling Blade is I accidentally saw that. I know. Sorry. I went to see it. It was sold out, or I had the time wrong. And so my friend and I wandered into Waiting for Guffman, which turned into my favorite film ever. And I saw it.
Oh, it's the best.
Angelica in New York City. Are you, Oh, is Waiting for Guffman on Amazon Prime?
Oh, interesting. I don't know.
I'm so happy.
I don't know.
And how's your new PC, by the way?
Congrats. I'll tell you what, it's going very well. I built it on stream on Friday, and I did have some issues building it where I twisted some pins wrong at first, but I got them bent back this weekend, and everything is operating perfectly now. The USB that I messed up is now working perfectly, and everything's great. Everything's great.
Help me fix my laptop, which I think is dead.
You know, laptops are a whole different world. You have to kind of buy a laptop, you know?
Yeah. My mom sent me an email. Stop throwing out your used tea bags. They're surprisingly useful. Here are 12 things you can do post brew.
Okay. Like what? What do you do with it?
Add a hint of flavor to, you know, should I put this up? Should I? Nah, it's over. I think I overused the screen.
Yeah, we don't need to. Right? Yeah, just tell us.
So here it is. Ready? Let's see, the first one, add a hint of flavor to rice or grains. Having your used tea bags in boiling water to infuse your food with a touch. Oh, hang your used tea bags in boiling water to infuse your food with a touch of flavor. Think jasmine tea rice or chai tea with oatmeal. Protect houseplants from fungal disease by rebrewing a used tea bag and using the weak tea cool to water your plants. Neutralize odors. Naturally spread dry tea leaves in stinky spots like cat litter box or in the bottom of your garbage bags. Oh, that's a good idea. Bottom garbage bags. By the way, can I tell you a life hack that I love?
Sure.
You put multiple garbage bags in the thing at once. It's so easy.
Oh.
I do three or four. I take three or four, just shove one in the other, put it in the box, whatever it's called, the structure. Then you fill it up and look what you don't need to do again. Put in another garbage bag. And no leaking because you already have three or something underneath it. And when you pick it up to drag it, it's just great. And you won't fill it. See, I think subconsciously you let the garbage bag get overflow more because it's just one more step. You're like, ugh, I don't want to change. I mean, I think this reveals either a genius or a real laziness, like combo. But I know there are people who this resonates with. So you,
take that and use it, you know?
Yeah. And then combine, take that and then take that tea bag, take that and put it in your garbage bags. make cleaning the fireplace safer and easier. Dump the damp content of tea bags into the ash to weigh it down before sweeping out the fireplace. That's safer. I don't know. Degrease pots and pans. Soak hard to clean dishes in water with a used tea bag tossed in. The tea will help loosen stuck on food and break up grease. Add them to your bath. The antioxidants in tea are good for your skin, and the gentle scent will add some aromatherapy to your soak. Take the sting out of insect bites and sunburns. Using a cool compress will reduce pain and inflammation. Make a hair rinse. Remove product buildup without using another product. Soak 3 to 4 used tea bags in warm water. Pour it over your head after shampooing and conditioning as usual. Don't rinse. Pro tip, chamomile brightens blondes and black tea adds a coppery shimmer to brunettes. Deodorize carpets by scattering the dry contents of several tea bags over your rugs before you vacuum. Depuff tired eyes. I do know that. Place cool tea bags over your eyes, cucumber style. According to Jason Green, the tannins in the tea leaves may reduce bags and circles. Clean leather shoes by buffing them with a tea bag and wash stinky hands using a tea bag.
Okay. I can do that.
All right. Cool. Well, I like this. Thanks. Thank you. Well, I think we learned a lot. And that's from Pocket Worthy. I still don't really understand how to use the app Pocket, Get Pocket. So if you guys want to sponsor me or have someone explain it to me and or both. I want to give a shout out to friends of show, Christian Parenti and Marcy Smith. They had a baby.
Shout very out.
Baby.
Congratulations.
Yes. His name is Jack.
And hey, good
very,
name.
Very, 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 very cute. He's like a chubby face, cute baby. So maybe next time I have Christian Parenti on, whose book Radical Hamilton you should buy. Maybe I'll have a little appearance. And everyone tell Christian that he needs to watch the movie Hamilton, right? If he, I mean the show, whatever, the Disney version of it. If he wrote a book, Radical Hamilton, yeah, you have to watch it.
Yeah, forget it. Don't watch it. I would say not I mean, to.
Yeah, but don't, as just like a pop culture thing. Like,
yeah, I guess.
Funny. He needs to be able to make fun of it. He also needs to get on Twitter. All right. Well, guys, thank you for coming. Thanks for the hangout. And I will see you guys Wednesday.
Good to see everybody. Thanks for coming by.
And check out Jack on Twitter.
I'm on Twitter at Jack Allison LOL. I do Twitch every Monday through Friday morning at twitch.tv/JackAM. And check out the Struggle Session podcast at sesh.plus.
And who was
sesh. On it? Plus. Katie was on the very excellent post-election emergency episode. We got a lot of comments on how good that episode was, Katie. Yeah, really? Katie's on one of the newest episodes, so check it out.
Yeah. This is interesting. One last thing. Owen Higgins, right? Left wing of the Democratic Party is coming to this debate with facts, figures, and data. Right wing is coming with anecdotes that can't back up. Amusing until you realize the former are the underdogs. True facts.
That's true. That is right.
Yeah.
That's right.
All righty. I will definitely see you guys Wednesday. And Jack, I'll see you next Sunday.
Yeah. See you then. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.